Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be an absolutely jam-packed marathon transmission today of overwhelming importance. We are so jam-packed today. First off, more and more top computer scientists and the real inventors of the internet have been signing letters in the last year saying that the military-industrial complex and corporations are trying to take the web over and are surveilling everyone illegally. So there is a mass revolt against the NSA in QTEL type controlled systems. Infopol 9 in Europe and the British system as well. There is a mass awakening within the top scientists themselves that we're going into serious tyranny and that major Western corporations are helping Russia and China censor their own web and trying to bring that here under the cybersecurity legislation. Sir Tim Berners-Lee has accused the government of draconian internet snooping, London Telegraph. He hasn't accused anybody. It's like saying he claims the sun came up this morning. No, we all know it came up this morning, okay? They try to teach in schools now to never be decisive, never have a view, never say, you know, they're in the fish tank. Which fish is the largest? Gee, I don't know. I mean, I run into these people with college degrees and think it's cool that they're indecisive. It's admitted there are scores of NSA whistleblowers that have gone public and said they're listening to everything you're doing. But it's in the Telecommunications Acts. It's in the Telecommunication Acts in Europe. Everything's got snooping hubs wired in. It's not denied. In fact, they kind of want you to know they're doing it to scare you, to make you shut up politically like you've done something bad. But on the other side, then, when it comes out it's illegal, they go, oh, we're not doing that. It's kind of like Bush saying torture's good. We're taking the gloves off. Yeah, I ordered torture, but, oh, that's a felony. Oh, well, I didn't order it. Send the people to prison. But then later writes a book bragging he ordered it. So they play this game of criminality with everybody. Now, NSA is huge news right now. I am going to announce here on air a nationwide protest of the criminal, illegal national security state that works for foreign banks. I had the idea yesterday. I'm going to codify it the next few days, and we're just going to have media protests. We're going to have protests outside these locations where they try to lie and say, you can't film us. You can go on Google Earth and see it. It's the idea of, you have no rights. You have no rights. And they're using the NSA to spy on journalists, to spy on Congress. They're using it to go after whistleblowers that expose corruption. This has become a very evil organization, and their own employees are coming out and saying this. We need to stand with the good people who are in the NSA. You know, this thing starts with, well, let's spy on the Russians, but of course it ends up being turned against the people domestically, just like you don't want your military used domestically. Now they say that's anti-military if you don't want to have the military operating domestically. No, that's called not living in North Korea or Venezuela or communist China. It's called living in a free country. And the prosperity comes with the liberty. So we're going to defend it. I will be protesting and standing up. And we're going to have a day where we all write articles about the NSA. Everybody does YouTubes about it, which is an NSA platform on record now. And where we also have phone conversations with each other and acknowledge that the NSA computers are listening. And I'll give you a spectrum of keywords, not the ones you think like bomb or drugs. No, it's going to be, I have the new super processor. Yes, we're rolling it out. It's going to be stuff like that. I'm going to teach you how to show them we know they're listening, and we're not intimidated. Because you know why? The NSA is now calling people here at the office. Yes, you heard me. Phone number comes up. We even have it on the smartphone showing. You call the number, it's the NSA. So now the NSA is calling us. It's a standard thing they do. They used to do that to me a long time ago. When that doesn't scare you, they call up and tell you what you were just talking about to try to freak you out. And so we're going to have Russell Dowden in here, who it just happened to. That's just part of what's coming up. It's a big transmission. It is Thursday, the 6th day of September, 2012. I am your host, Alex Jones, and we have got an absolutely supercharged, turbocharged, liberty-charged transmission lined up for you today. Transmitting across North America on XM Channel 166, blasting out on over 115 AM and FM affiliates, and, of course, going out streaming at Infowars.com and Prisonplanet.com with the free audio streams and later the podcast, as well as video streams at Prisonplanet.tv and worldwide over the web, as well as WWCR 100,000-watt global service, 6 hours a day, the daytime show, and then retransmitted at night. Find all the details at Infowars.com, Infowars.com/listen. Now, continuing here, ladies and gentlemen, we have got quite a challenge here today of news and information to cover. We don't normally have a day like this, but so much news is taking place just inside the InfoWars operation. Our reporters went out to the Austin airport yesterday to try to talk to the public relations person, and they were threatened. Well, they were told they were detained. They implied they were going to arrest them for simply showing up at the airport. Because we're enemy Americans. I mean, we're here to be Pavlovianly trained to have strange men stick their hands down our pants or take us in rooms and, you know, take our children's underwear off. We're taught that after we go through the so-called checkpoint for security, the harassment conditioning, slave training point, prisoner training point, that we need to, you know, then have our drinks and food inspected by them that we buy in front of them at Starbucks or McDonald's. So all of that is going on, and we have the footage and the report. They're going to be joining us coming up in about an hour and 20 minutes from now in studio. Dan Bedondi, as well as John Bound, also with Linda West, they all went down there. And it's pretty powerful footage. They're very polite. And then the TSA and the police show up like, well, you're evil people pointing cameras at us. We point cameras at you, slave. So that is coming up. I'll play a short clip of that in a moment just to give you an idea of what's coming up. We're going to have Russell Dowden, who heads up my InfoWars newspaper / magazine operation. He got something that I've gotten 6-7 times over the years, the NSA phone call, where it's the NSA. You call, you pick the phone up, and no one's there. You hang up. You call back on the caller ID if it's a landline or your cell phone. And it's National Security Agency. May I help you? Then you don't believe it's the NSA. And you go online and check the phone number. And it's the NSA. The head guy in there over my newspaper and the six people back there got that call. And so we're going to show you a screenshot of his phone. We're going to show you the phone on air if you're watching at PrisonPlanet.tv. And we're going to call the number on air. We're going to call the NSA and ask them why they're calling us. Now, again, if that doesn't scare you, then they start calling up and saying, hey, just heard you talking to your mom. Yeah, I hope she dies in the hospital. So they want to scare you next. Like, oh, you didn't get the hint we're criminals. You didn't get the hint that we're lawless. You didn't get the hint we're here to intimidate. You're supposed to run and hide like an enemy of the state. No, no, we're not running and hiding. You're going to run and hide. You're going to run and hide, criminals. You understand that? Oh, you think you're intimidating us. Like, we don't know you're listening. We don't know you're watching. We're listening and we're watching from history. And we're going to film you in public. The police in L.A. are saying it's terrorism to film anywhere, basically, and are arresting people. Well, they're getting out later. The point is that they want to start snatching us off the streets. They want to get a North Korea going. They want to get a Ceausescu going. They're hungry for it. That's the big preparation. So that is coming up. Tyrell Ventura will be joining us for about 10 minutes because I got the good news a few days ago, but he can announce it now. And his father's coming on next week, former Governor Jesse Ventura. The show, the third season that was shot last year that I'm in, that is real reality TV. Let me tell you, we're out there on the streets. I mean, there's, you know, blow-ups with David Icke. I mean, it's most reality TV is not reality TV. They don't really even call this reality TV, but it is. It's strange. But the point is that That is going to air now, coming up right after the election. First episode, Wednesday nights, November 7th. So Tyrell will be popping in about that. We also have a mother on who runs the website Free Range Kids. All over the country, CPS is coming. Now have your kids in the backyard, not just in the front yard or running around like we all did, you know, in the neighborhood. I mean they're saying 12-year-olds should be inside, you know, drinking aspartame, eating GMO, and watching brainwashing television, or you're not a good globalist. And then we have Steve and Andrea Hernandez. They have made big national news fighting the slave necklaces that they wear at San Antonio schools that are Department of Defense run. They also have AI computers watching the children eat their food to track, quote, their calorie intake. I mean, it's a total high-tech prison grid. Bill Gates is coming out with bracelets that you wear that track your heartbeat and if you're focused. Just the total prisoner sci-fi training, conditioning the next generation for strip searches, everything else. They're fighting back against that because I guess they're not good globalists. So that is what we have lined up for you today here on the good old Alex Jones Show, or what I call InfoWars Live. I wanted to call the show back when it got syndicated in 1997 when we began getting on a few stations. I wanted to call it InfoWars. And I think Genesis folks, Ted Anderson at the time, Michael Trudeau, who was working there, a good guy, were right when they said, you know, people don't know what InfoWars is yet. And for ratings, stations need to hear your name a lot so people put it in the little Arbitron book. And so, well, let's call it the Alex Jones Show, which I always thought was a bit pretentious, but it is the Alex Jones Show officially. We call the video stream of it that's at prisonplanet.tv InfoWars Live, because this is the live TV / radio show. It's really radio / TV. About 98% of the audience is radio, but it tends to all be geared towards visual. So that we can show you videos, show you documents. Because in the past, people just didn't believe this stuff. And we'd say, hey, we have footage of, you know, this horrible thing happening. Oh, I bet you do, pal. And I bet Martians are on the moon and eat my brain. Hey, the black helicopters just blew up a building next to a nursing home and one lady died of a heart attack. Sure they did, Jones. Well, no, I have the footage. I bet you do, pal. Well, it's even in the local news. Yeah, sure it is. Well, now we can cram everything right into people's eyeballs. Okay, let me get into some of the other, big news that we have coming up here today. More and more, we are able to make the establishment respond. A year and a half ago, the White House came out, attacked the Drudge Report, InfoWars.com, our story on DrudgeReport.com, and said our policies are not going to increase power prices, even though the energy commissions of the states were saying it, and power prices have now, in some areas, doubled, like where I live in Austin. Other areas have about 25% in the last 3.5 years. And now they're set to shut down in the next year 1/3 of existing coal plants that supply over 50%, 51% of the power. So they came out and responded to that. I mean, there's countless examples, but now it's every week. And even when the mighty Drudge doesn't link to our story, we're able now, thanks to InfoWarriors and listeners and AM and FMs and people out there, to have our stories responded to in a big way. And you saw this with our stories about the 1.4 billion bullet purchases and the armored pillboxes, the big giant wheeled tanks. The AP, USA Today, CNN, Detroit Free Press, hundreds of newspapers running the AP article, came out and said, Jones is a conspiracy theorist. He says they bought these rounds of ammo for civil unrest, even though the Army manual says that, that we link to. It's only 174,000 rounds, and it's for Social Security criminal fraud enforcers. And they're hollow point, and that's what you use at the shooting range. Jones is lying, too. You don't use full metal jacket at the shooting range. You use hollow point. It's quite normal. And they had the dean of a law enforcement school say so. So it doesn't matter if that's not true. Just, you know, they said so. So all of that's going on. Well, the dean just said they need this ammo. And that, you know, the hollow, and then others in the article said the hollow points are quite normal. That's what you use for shooting target practice. I mean, anybody who knows guns knows that's not true, but so what? They're illegal to use in war. But continuing under the Geneva Convention, but that doesn't matter. So continuing with this, they came out, and there's still new articles today, scores of them, saying, look, Jones, you know, made up. This was for civil unrest. It's 174,000 rounds of ammo. Just missing everything else in the article, the 1.4 billion. That's why people are upset, but they make it about 174,000. Same thing with the drones. We're like, they're using drones to arrest people. Here's examples in North Dakota and this place and that. And they go find some other article where the EPA is harassing farmers with manned Cessnas, harassing feedlots and things. So they build a straw man, change the subject. It's happened again. We're going to cover this when we come back. It was in AP, Reuters, hundreds of TV stations that I can see, just everywhere. Reason Magazine, CBS News, after Drudge linked to our articles earlier this week and had it featured for 2 days, that the TSA is setting up checkpoints nationwide with video of it on highways and shopping malls and everywhere else and into political functions. And the other article was that they're showing them at Starbucks and places inside the airport, walking over and sticking testers in your drink. Hundreds of publications ran with it, saying, I mean, even mainstream media was like, yeah, why are they testing? They say it's to be unpredictable, but this doesn't make sense. So they kind of jumped the shark, as the Daily Poll said, the TSA did. Well, guess what happened? There was a call about a liquid explosive. Turned out it was a false alarm and a hoax, but that's now being reported, you know, page 20. There was a scare this morning. Oh, maybe the TSA will get some drugged up patsy on the plane with a liquid explosive, like they admit they got caught doing 2 years ago with the Christmas bomber. Top stories up at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com right now. DARPA emergency response robot runs faster than the fastest man in the world. So DARPA emergency response, and of course they're killer robots. They just always roll stuff out as safety. Oh, the drones are for safety. Oh, now they're armed. So DARPA emergency response robot runs faster than world's fastest man. Combat attack robots, ground robots. Oh, yeah, it's not just the drones, folks. They've got the killer robots, all of it. It's your money. You build them. You pay for it. And you are the slave. Enjoy. Freedom of Information Act letters reveals shocking case of TSA groping genitals savagely. They literally try to crush them like eggs just to make you submit. It's all part of the domination until people complained. Again, it's because these are sadists. Who wants to do that all day? 83,046 for a three-hour hospital visit. $83,000. Why are hospital bills so outrageous? That's a key report. Delusional reality, everything peddled by politicians, media, banks, and television is fiction or mixed with fiction by Mike Adams. That is just some of what we're going to be covering. Also, masked UK, US, French navies drill simulated breach of blocked Strait of Hormuz, so they're gearing up for war. Pulitzer Prize journalist warns of physical roundups of political dissidents under Lord Obama. Chemtrails that don't exist cost $5 billion a year to produce. They just admit it all, but then say it doesn't exist. Dinosaur Media runs cover for DHS $1.4 billion ammo buy. But speaking of that, we're going to get more into the TSA and Artel run-in, daring to as media to go down to the airport. Oh, police had to come. Whoa, you're not terrorist, are you? Whoa, you know, with reporters walking up with microphones. No, sir, bad. That's scary. And so it's been in CBS News, you name it. Literally hundreds of TV stations have carried it. I mean, so many articles, I can't even keep track of it. Here's one. Why is TSA mission creeping into DNC convention security? Here's another one. TSA says bizarre new policy, business as usual. Here is the CBS News. Flyers video puts TSA drink screening on display. Then it covers Infowars.com. TSA looking for Al-Qaeda in your coffee. Huffington Post, TSA tests drinks post-security at Columbus Airport. So the point is, I'm not going to keep going through these. This is a giant stack of, here's the Daily Poll saying that the TSA has jumped the shark testing beverages after the security checkpoint. It just goes on and on. Literally hundreds of articles. I can't even look at them all. It'll just, you know, say this article and 40 more, this article and 100 more. So there's hundreds. Now, the point is, what did they then do? This was very easy to predict. We were even talking just yesterday. I said, watch them do something where they find liquid explosives. And their favorite thing is they'll have a green beret. They'll order him to do a security drill. They'll set the guy up. He'll say, hey, I was told it was part of a drill. They'll go, sure, they wouldn't be setting you up, Special Forces man or Iraq, you know, vet, if that wasn't true. We don't set up veterans. They're like, I was told to do it. How about 45 years in prison? Shut up and we may let you out. Okay? So if you're cops, if you're military, if you're, you know, a cadet or something, and they tell you to do something like this, 9 times out of 10, it is just a drill. But the other time, you're going to be on the news because Al-Qaeda isn't the enemy now. It's the gun owners, the libertarians, the returning veterans. You're the new enemy. You're what the armored vehicles and the SWAT teams and the ROTC drill to fight. That's always been the case. Now it's just public. You knew it would happen, though. Dallas Morning News, hoax about, and I heard it this morning. I said, that'll be a hoax. And then by the time I got to the office, it was a hoax. Hoax, but it doesn't matter. That's now back in the paper. Hoax about explosive orders Dallas-bound flight from Philadelphia, order back to gate. Somebody said that the FBI said there was liquid explosives on board. And then it was plastic explosives. And then here it is, LA Times. Liquid explosive fears forces plane back to Philadelphia, LA Times. L.A. Times at 7:28. Oh, but by 8:25, it was a hoax. It was a hoaxy. A hoaxy. While it's all over the news that they're sticking tabs in your drink. Hey, I'm glad they're sticking things in the Coca-Cola I just bought at McDonald's at the airport. I mean, they're right there. Oh, you just bought that. You're like, why are you going to do this? Well, they could be Al-Qaeda in there. You know, we got to check your daughter's pants as well. Because, you know, I'm a convicted pedophile, the TSA guy says. You're like, well, after all, we need felons to search our children. It makes sense.
We're on the march.
We are back live, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining us on this Thursday edition. We have a jam-packed transmission coming up. InfoWars reporters are harassed and they're told, you know, that you can't leave, but you're not detained by Austin police and others for daring to come with cameras to the Austin airport. Scum Americans will learn soon. Out in L.A., they're now arresting people, basically filming anywhere. You're not allowed to do that in Land of the Free, Home of the Brave. You're not allowed to have a garden in your backyard, scum. You're not allowed to raise your children and not take vaccines, filth. You will do what you're told. So that is coming up. And then Russell Dowden, he's got it on his phone. They called him. Says, incoming call, NSA. This has happened to me where the NSA calls you. And they don't talk. And then you call them back and the NSA answers. And then you check the number and it's the public relations number for the National Security Agency. We're going to call the NSA on air later. And the real inventor of the internet, Sir Tim Berners-Lee, is saying that the NSA and other systems are spying on everyone. And, quote, the internet is going into a new dark age. He breaks all of that down and says that we have a draconian government. I had Pulitzer Prize winner on Chris Hedges yesterday saying the same thing. Former bureau chief for the New York Times for the Middle East. And I have, you know, you name it, Congress people on. Everyone agrees. I had Dr. Stallman on yesterday, the inventor of free, what led into open source software systems. He totally agrees. I mean, we're in trouble. If you got an IQ above room temperature, you know we're going the direction of North Korea, and we're moving fast, okay? So that's all coming up with Russell Dowden as well. And they're now grabbing people's kids if you dare let them play outside. We've got the head of the Free Range Kids website, Lenore. How do you pronounce her name, guys? Skenazy, coming on the show. So look forward to that. We're going to Tyrell Ventura here in just one moment. Gold is exploding as well right now, and we're going to be breaking down some of that information as well coming up in the next segment. It's up $12.10 as of about 25 seconds ago, and we predicted that would happen when the fall kicked off and it's beginning, because now the Fed's saying, yeah, we'll do QE3 if we need to. So we thought we were wrong. We thought it would happen late last year, early this year, but they've got to do it or things will even implode more. So you're darned if you do, darned if you don't. You're up the creek without a paddle either way. But first, here's a short clip of Dan Bedondi, Linda West, and John Bowen, our reporters, when they were down at the airport yesterday. The full clip is coming up with them in studio at the bottom of the next hour. Here it is.
I'm sorry, you took an oath upon the Constitution to defend it. And which
I took it.
You did. Every officer does. I have many family who are airport police in Providence, Rhode Island, and people who are in state police as well. You take an oath upon the Constitution to have that badge upon your chest, sir. And the Constitution is to defend the Constitution and its republic, not take orders from these tyrannical people in Homeland Security.
These aren't tyrannical people.
They are, sir. It's on record. It's on record. These guys put the State Department put the underwear bomb on the plane.
Obviously, you want to be confrontational?
No, not at all.
Yes, you do.
I'm just trying to address you as a citizen to citizen. That's all.
You can't.
We didn't do that, sir.
Okay. You went up to one of their BDOs, and he didn't want to ask your questions.
Yeah, and we respected that.
We didn't.
Yeah, all we asked is for a PIO.
All right, great job, Dan Bedondi and crew. That's coming up at the bottom of the hour. I take you now to a victory for the First Amendment with the son of Jesse Ventura, but filmmaker, TV host, actor, producer, incredible cameraman. That's what I really admire, being on a bunch of these shoots with him, is the eye that Tyrell Ventura has with cameras and the shots he gets. I've learned a lot from this guy just on that front. Tyrell Ventura joins us again. And he is one of the co-producers and new host of the popular third season Conspiracy Theory, also with the son, a filmmaker and actor in his own right, of legendary director Oliver Stone, Sean Stone, friend of the show, friend of mine as well. And we're also twisting Tyrell's arm to try to get Harry Dean Stanton, who I was invited to he and Jesse's birthday party. I didn't bug him at the birthday party to come on, but I should have, because I want to get Harry Dean Stanton on the show as well to get his view on things. Hey, we had Christopher Walken on a few weeks ago. Gotta have him. Going to Tyrell Ventura, good news. Homeland Security threatened and everything and got him to erase and not air the Homeland Security episode that I helped produce on the FEMA camps. It's supposed to air about 50 times over a year. It aired once. They erased it off DVRs. All sorts of harassment that I was told about, but not at liberty to talk about. People say, hey, we'll tell you this. People always say, hey, you have these big meetings with a globalist, or you have this source, tell us. No one would ever give me sources again if I burned people. Someday, I hope Jesse and others will tell you the stuff that went on. But let me tell you, they didn't want, they were mad about the second season. True TV did give them the authorization to do this because Ventura demanded to have free reign. And then pressure came in. Now, in the third season, they kind of took it away for 8-9 months and re-edited it. So who knows what's going to come out. I hope it's going to be good, but it does pique my interest. It's going to start airing in November, right after the election. And Tyrell, I mean, I think this is a victory for the First Amendment. What do you say?
Well, I think it's a wonderful day. You know, once again, the show's November 7th, 10 p.m. You know, they're back on Wednesdays rather than Fridays, so we don't have to, you know, compete with people going out Friday night, things like that. So, you know, it shows that they are coming back with a lot of faith in the show and things like that. And, you know, like I said, once again, they didn't really take it away from us for 8 months as much as just a lot of, you know, like explained to the show before, explained on your show before, there was, you know, we have to brought in a new EP and then kind of liaise between the networks. So we ended up having to.
Okay, absolutely. I'm technically wrong. The point is they brought in new people and sat there and kind of redid it over 8-9 months. And so, yeah. I mean, they changed the project. Go ahead.
Oh, no. Yeah. But the nice thing is, you know, I've seen the episodes that are going to be airing and things like that. And they look fantastic. You know, it's definitely a lot. It's definitely going to be a fun show this year. I mean, we tackle some subjects I think that people aren't going to quite expect Jesse to tackle. We get into issues that he doesn't believe, you know, which a lot of times in the shows, you know, we'd always kind of go forward with things that, you know, he kind of had an initial instinct to, ooh, you know, something might be a little wonky in Denmark there. But this year we kind of, you know, we went after some controversial issues within the conspiracy theory world, you know, out there in the ether, you know. So it's going to be a good season, man. It's wild and woolly, and it was a lot of fun working with Sean Stone, and it's going to be a good show.
Tyrell, I got to tell you, you look ultra cool on the Skype right now. I'm telling you,
my first Skype appearance on your show. I figured I had to gussy it up a little bit.
No. I tell you, Tyrell, there is so much to go over here. But kind of give us a little bit of a sneak peek of what's coming up. Your father would say, hey, I've done the research. Wall Street's running scams. Let's go investigate. He'd go talk to Wall Street insiders. Or we know what's happening with water, what they're putting in the water, the lithium, the fluoride, but also that they're gobbling it up and handing it over to foreign powers, foreign corporations. And issues like that, real meat and potatoes that never been on TV. Normally a conspiracy show would do the mind control of the little green men or chupacabras or reptoids or you know things like that first and then never do the two seasons you did. This time, you're going out and doing some of the other secret space program type stuff. I mean, there's a lot of really hardcore serious ones as well. But you guys also approach the issues that have been seen as a little more out there, but in a serious way. Most of those shows, well, I don't want to sit here and interview myself, but talk about that.
Well, you know, we decided this year that there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of conspiracies, like you say, that are to the average John Q citizen a little bit more out there and like, whoa, that sounds a little nuts. And so we decided to see what Jesse's take would be on these. And so as an investigative team, we started to go in there and seeing, you know, how much, you know, fact is within the fiction and how much fiction is within the facts. And because we felt, you know, it's a service, we're an informational show, we're an entertainment show and an informational show. And we felt that it would be a good idea to get into a little bit more of those out there subjects just to kind of see, you know, how much truth is there to them. If there's truth, we put it on the air. If they're not truthful, then we put that on the air just to show that, you know, we don't always just push the agenda of conspiracy. There are a lot of bogus conspiracies as much as there's real conspiracies. And hopefully we can shed a little bit more light on all those this year. And it's going to be a hell of a season. I mean, it was a lot of fun to shoot. It was a breakneck schedule and shooting. And you know, I'm sorry for the delay, but we are back on, you know, November 7th at 10 p.m. So it's you know, tune in. We finally made it on the air.
Exactly. Well, it almost piques the interest more, and it's on Wednesday nights, which in its original slot, it got top ratings. It still did very well on a Friday slot, known to be the place they put things to die. But now it's back like the Phoenix because
it didn't die.
Yes.
And I thank you all. I thank you all for keeping us on. You know, I mean, we had a hell of a second season. And that's one of the main reasons they brought us back. You know, we're a season to season show, so the viewership counts. You know, they don't have us slated for three more seasons after this. We go season to season. So you guys' support and viewership is what's important. The viewer mail that they get, things like that. These are all important things to keep us on the air.
Now, expanding on this, because I haven't seen the edits. I mean, I was part of some of the shows, consulted some, but I haven't seen it, so I don't know. But from what I saw, you guys really go out, and what you see is real, and you try to discover what's happening. But the subjects before were pretty much vetted. You know, is global warming real, or is it a scam? All of this, and then you go out and really interview the experts on both sides. In this case, you guys really didn't know. And you truly went out to investigate, you know, things that you guys thought might be baloney. And there's some confrontations here. So it's not so much a debunking show. But
no,
when you run into bull, though, I think there is some debunking. I mean, is that accurate?
It's not a debunking show at all. Jesse's standard kind of rules and laws that he put out to us as the investigators were, you bring me what is truth. You know, and that's his rule. If it, whatever the truth is, as best we can, you know, figure it out from the experts we talk to and the locations we go to, you bring me back the truth, no matter how crazy and weird it is. So, no, it's not a debunking show. We never went out saying, oh, we're going to debunk this and we're going to throw this out. If in the process of an investigation, we prove or we see that, you know, that it just doesn't quite hold water, we tell the truth about it. Doesn't quite hold water. The same as if we, in the process in the investigation, if we suddenly see that, wow, this is actually this, there's some fire amidst the smoke here. We show that, you know,
talk about some of the
we don't start with an agenda. We start from simply, OK, here's the experts. Here's the facts that are known. Let's go out and see if this is accurate.
And I can 100% attest to this being part of all three seasons that you guys say, let's go see what's happening in Wall Street. Let's go see what's happening with the water. Let's go see what's happening in Area 51. Let's go investigate this and go out and do it. You know, my point is, this is a little more wild, some of the subjects, What, like half the episodes are what would be seen as traditionally kind of out there?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, to John Q. Citizen, who's not, you know, awake to these sort of things, all of our subjects are a little bit out there.
Exactly.
But you know, I think you have to be honest no matter what. So you know, there's a whole realm of conspiracies that exist that are you know, much more, I guess you would say, fantastic and even science fiction-y when you first kind of just see the byline of what it is, and you're like, that can't be really. And then, you know, that was what was fascinating for me. I mean, I got turned around on a few things where I kind of was looking at something going like, oh, come on, this can't be real. But then you get out there into some situations and you know, boots on the ground kind of stuff. And, you know, there was some pretty hairy moments and some pretty interesting stuff that truly shook me to my core and some of the things that I saw and witnessed being an investigator in the field. I mean, previous 2 years, I was in the home office producing and then putting the show together. This year, I'm out in the muck and running around and getting into some pretty wild situations with me and Mr. Stone.
Well, I mean, don't sell yourself short. You did a lot of the camera work and stuff that I saw even on the first episode. I mean, you're out in the field some, but this time you're actually 100%, I guess, out there.
Well, yeah, and we made that decision namely because you know, Jesse in his battle with the TSA, he won't fly. At the time we were shooting the show, he was in the middle of the lawsuit, and then after losing the lawsuit, having the judge throwing out his suit, you know, he refused to fly to this day and takes a train. So one of the reasons that they thought that they could bring me and Stone in is not only get the new generation of conspiracy hunters, but as well as, you know, it keeps Ventura's name alive, you know.
And it gives the TSA a chance to stick their hands in another Ventura pants. I mean, that's important to be able to. I mean, Ron Paul gets abused.
It's not fun to fly. I refuse to go through the microwave machines.
Well, that's extremist. I mean, even though top doctors admit it can give you cancer. How much can you get into? I mean, just giving us an idea. I mean, I know, you know, the episodes, but I mean, can you tell us some of the episodes that are covered? I mean, obviously, there's the private space program information. Did that make the cut?
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to give away everything right now, man. I'm sure that information will come out as we go along, and you know that we'll put it on your show first, you know, as soon as we need to keep my mouth shut
is what you're saying. I'm just asking here on air.
Well, you know, I think right now, I just want to get everyone know that the show's coming on, and you know, as soon as we get the green light, you know, and when we do the press junket and get everybody's attention, we'll get more into the details.
We don't want to talk out of school and spoil it for everybody, but I mean, give us one of the scariest moments, though, or give us a little giblet.
One of the scariest moments I had was running around and investigating an area in Utah that definitely shook me.
That was on the Indian reservation, right?
It was a very interesting night.
You know. Yeah, to say the least, I tell you. Man, I can't wait to be able to talk about this stuff.
Oh, I can't wait. And, you know, because I don't know the order of what the episodes are going to come in yet. So, I mean, I don't want to, you know, speak out of place on that. But I think definitely when the season gets going, I think definitely you'll see me. You know, I'll come on every week after a show airs or the day of a show airs or something like that, and then we'll talk about the show and, you know, maybe take some callers and ask what they thought of the shows and things like that. I think it'd be a great idea.
All right, we're gonna go to break. Come back with 5 more minutes or 6 minutes in the short segment on the other side. Then we've got we got our crew coming in here who just went down to try to talk to the public information officer. They even call just the PR people officers now. The mayor calls himself an officer where I live. We're all civilian scum. And they let us know, you know, you watch yourself, you American filth. You don't have a First Amendment, pound sand. So that's coming up. And we got a call from the NSA yesterday. We'll be right back. Stay with us. You know, we come as a man. Yeah, first he's in the back. Now he's in the front. We are talking to Tyrell Ventura, going back to him in just a moment with some final tidbits on, hey, the good news, Conspiracy Theory, third season, very exciting, with Jesse Ventura, Tyrell Ventura, and Sean Stone, myself, and many others. Honored to be part of it. We'll, of course, have the David Icke confrontation, which was not intentional, but they were pretty freaked out when that happened and called me after it happened. So I can, I even told David, you know, off air and on air, I said that was not on purpose. So they just, it clashed. But I guess you'll get to see that. I hope that's going to be in there. In fact, going to Ty. Ty, can you tell us, did that make the cut, or we're just going to have to wait and see?
No, the David Icke, what happened with David is in the show, and we presented it honestly for what happened. And you know, two big personalities that got in the same room and you know, you know, it was an interesting conversation between the two of them. I mean, yeah. It wasn't just they came in the room and started like brawling with each other or anything like that. I mean, they had a conversation. In that conversation,
yeah.
They started to disagree.
Well, I mean, I've gotten your perspective, your dad's and David's, and it's pretty much everybody says the same thing. But I told David, I said, David, you don't understand. The talk you have is real, and out in the field, it's boom. But when they do an interview, they spent 40 minutes lighting you to make you look good. And they kept Jesse away from you when you wanted to meet him, not because he wanted to be rude to you, but they want it to be so real. And David felt, because I talked to him on and off air, he said, yeah, they made me sit there for an hour while Ventura's right next door. I wanted to go talk to him. They said no. And I think he just totally misunderstood. He's from television, but not from reality TV. And I go, look, he used to be top BBC presenter. This is how they do it now. This was not personal. So he was already mad before it even began. And
on like a talk show or something like that, you know, the host and the guest will sit down and kind of talk things out. But we found that you know, Jesse is such a lively speaker, and he loves to talk. I mean, you know, and I know off camera, on camera, he just loves to talk. And loves to talk to people. And we just found in the process of doing the show that you miss certain great moments, you know, where he'll start talking to a guest before we start rolling and they'll have an amazing conversation. And then, you know, then you have to redo it. And it's always never quite as good as
but
it is.
But you know your dad better than I, but knowing him now for about 7 years, he'll talk, but suddenly when he's done, he's done.
And so we always try to keep Jesse, you know, as best we can. You know, we try to keep him, you know, separate from the person we're interviewing for as long as we can, just because we want to get, you know, that.
Yeah, but I've been on Discovery and History Channel shows, and they do the same thing. They don't put me with the person I'm going to debate. They don't put me with the host first. They want it to be real. They want that first electricity, like, boom, you know, here you go.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, and then we'll have, you know, an hour long conversation that we then have to cut down into 10 minutes because we're only an hour long show, you know, but it's, you know, it wasn't done on purpose. It wasn't something where we were like, oh, you know, we got to keep the, you know, David sequestered and all that. It's just,
no, he totally misunderstood. And I'm glad you've said this because I'll send it to David because, you know, I like both men. I obviously know your dad a lot better, but I've known David for about 15 years over the phone, and I know your dad personally very well, but it's just sad to see that. But it'll make for very exciting television. Listen, Ty, thank you so much. Give us your dad's website and give us your website.
Once again, it's weaintgottimetobleed.com, and then also Jesse Ventura, the official Facebook page. I'm a little behind on updating We Ain't Got Time to Bleed. I've been caught up in a lot of things. Facebook's a little easier for me to update, and for Jesse to update, it's a little
all
easier
right.
for him to hit the.
We got to have you on soon about all the other projects you got going. Thanks for coming on with us. We'll be right back. All right, we got 2 hours stretching out before us. Document cam, please. With a plethora, a cornucopia, a veritable plethora. Would you say I have a plethora? So that is all coming up here today. It is insane amounts of news. The real inventor of the internet, it's not Al Gore. It's Sir Tim Berners-Lee. There's about 15 guys. They're all guys and evil men. And which we just not have internet because men invented it. But the point is, I'm now being sarcastic. The point is that he's come out and said, the governments are spying on you. There's a new dark age here. We've got to stand up against this. Well, he's obviously an extremist and has to be dealt with, you know, for not wanting our governments to fund Al-Qaeda to then menace us so they can take our liberties. And DARPA emergency response robot can run as fast as the fastest man in the world. In fact, faster. But, of course, it's for the military to save you. It certainly won't be used against you. Everything is fine. The government cares a lot about you. You know, I've got a lot of other huge items I'm going to be covering today, but This story out of the smokinggun.com is another example, just another amazing example of how they go after people like Martha Stewart for a crooked toenail. Well, she didn't do anything. They got her on lying to the feds, though, they claim. That's why the feds talk to you. It's like, hey, talk to the hand. You want to talk to that? Hey, how's that Fast and Furious going for you over there? But Shepard Fairey is now admitting that when the AP sued him over the Hope image, which he could have probably beat them. I mean, I know copyright law pretty darn good because he posterized it, changed the color, everything. I mean, it's almost completely different, and it's political. Or they would have gotten a tiny licensing fee. But instead, he went and doctored the stuff that he had come up with it, and he got caught because all the digital stuff has little back doors, paper printers have date printers on them. Everything's meant to track you. Everything's a giant surveillance grid. And now they're trying to throw him in prison. Feds seek prison time for Obama Hope artist. Man, I wish the feds would seek time for their former boss at the Obama administration on the Economic Council, John Corzine, who stole billions and got caught lying to Congress. Wish you'd go after him. Wish you'd go after the Solyndra people. Wish you'd go after the Chicago Mafia that runs you. Wish you would go after yourselves. But, oh, no, Shepard Fairey. Federal prosecutors want Shepard Fairey, an artist who created the Barack Obama Hope poster, to serve time in prison following his misdemeanor conviction for destroying and fabricating documents in connection with the civil lawsuit over the iconic campaign. The guy made $3 million 1 year, $5 million another, $6 million another. Of course, now you can't make anything off of it. But in 07, 08, and 09, 09 was the peak of Obama mania when they were saying he was Christ and stuff. So that's $11 million. $14 million. He made $14 million. And instead of just fighting the case forever with the Associated Press, he went and fabricated a bunch of stuff. I mean, obviously, when the Associated Press sues you for millions of dollars, that's not what they're going to get. Man, people are so ignorant. But I mean, what do you expect? He was an anti, kind of like the Adbuster people, you know, anti-commercialism, anti-capitalist, communism is rebellion, communism is cool, you know, all this stuff. And then he has stores all over the country and all this money and makes hundreds of millions of dollars a year, gross. And then he doesn't want to pay somebody, even if he couldn't beat him, because I believe it's his image. I mean, it's totally different. So instead he goes and engages in fraud, which is exactly what a communist liberal would do. They would become filthy rich and then be so stupid they wouldn't even know how to defend themselves and fall into the spider web of the degenerate federal government. We'll be back.
If you want an...
Tell your children not to walk my way.
Monday through Friday.
Tell your children not to hear my words.
11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central.
Mother.
We're here live.
Mother.
We are here in an attempt to lift the veil from people's eyes. We want people to not live in the darkness of the New World Order. And we don't run from the darkness. We face it head on with pleasure, because that is a free human's destiny. Coming up, DARPA, emergency response. It's really a combat robot, runs faster than the fastest human. It has the world land record now. Bipedal attack robots. The TSA is now responding to us all over the country, saying they've got to test your drinks after the checkpoint that you buy at Starbucks or at Whataburger or whatever the places they have at the airport, because there may be explosives in it. It's about training you that you're a prisoner, that you're bad, that you're a suspect, and only government's good. It's a new class system. And we now have a hoax. It was later admitted a hoax, just a fake hoax, that there was a liquid bomb on an aircraft from Philadelphia to Dallas and had to turn back. Just total hoax, but back of the paper hours later, oh, yeah, it was a hoax. But, hey, we need to test because, you know, the guy might have got a bomb at the coffee shop. That's what they're saying, and was going to blow you up with a coffee. Just right as they're being exposed, that magically happens. The same TSA worked with the federal government to get the underwear bomber on the on the aircraft 2 years ago, 1 week before the rollout of the scanners that had been purchased a year before and were being delivered. And they said, oh, we're putting these in because of this guy now. Total lie, totally transparent, in your face. By the way, I saw police officers at the pool today doing their training, and most of them couldn't swim. By the way, I got footage of that. That'll be on the nightly news tonight. Police officers and, well, cadets. The trainers could hardly swim. And then they had the cadets, a bunch of them, like, were having to be hauled out. They couldn't swim. But they'll be pulling me over very soon. They know how to write a ticket and make some money. So we're going to be discussing all of that. It's pretty amazing footage I got. We're always on the job. I'm down there swimming, and guys in camo start walking by me. And I'm like, what is this? And I go, and it was the police in camouflage. They had all their gear and everything, and they set it up and started getting in. And they were having to haul guys out who couldn't swim. So I didn't realize. A cross-sampling of people, you don't have that many people that can't swim. Something weird's going on. But they're not letting people with Down syndromes fly on planes now because it upsets the other passengers if someone sits there quietly drinking a bottle of water. So I think you might get better officers from what I saw out of someone with Down syndrome, and I'm not joking. At least they have more humanity. Okay, I'm not being mean. I don't hate police. It was just shocking, and I'm going to talk about it later. Now, we are joined by a very interesting lady here on the transmission today. In fact, I'm looking for her bio, and she's Lenora Skenazy, and she is a syndicated columnist, author, and public speaker who delivers lively, hands-on parenting seminars at universities and community centers. She has spoken to audiences internationally and appeared on Dr. Phil and Good Morning America and many other Nightline, you name it. In addition to founding the Free Range Kids blog, book, and movement, she has written for everyone from the Washington Post to Mad Magazine, and graduated from Yale and Columbia. She lives in New York City with her husband and two sons, and she thinks children shouldn't just watch television all day. She's an extremist. FreeRangeKids.wordpress.com. And, of course, we had our article, Cops Interrogate Family for Allowing Kids to Play Outside. And even in backyards now, children are being taken. You don't do that. Social services harass mother for having free-range children. So in the new country where you can't have backyard gardens, can't have lemonade stands, well, pretty soon you won't be able to have more than one kid. Thank you for coming on, ma'am.
It's a pleasure to be here, Alex. Thank you.
Good to have you. Okay, well, tell us about this evil movement you're part of. I mean, you're claiming that once children played outside, I think that sounds extreme. Al-Qaeda could get them.
That's right. And in a way, Al-Qaeda is. We just call it CPS, Child Protective Services. What's happening, what I hear about a lot at the Free Range Kids blog is, excuse me, parents who let their children play outside, walk to school, go to the grocery for them, often have neighbors who turn them in, supposedly out of concern for them.
Good really Stasi, good people.
Yes, reminds me of the KGB. And what happens? Child Protective Services is obligated to come and check out whether or not these parents really are being negligent or worse, abusive. And what has happened is that the parents are found wrong by the police or by Child Protective Services for leaving their children in what CPS calls a dangerous situation, which I would call a normal, nice situation. In fact, less dangerous than just letting your kids sit inside all day, getting fat and diabetic. You let your kids run outside or have some independent adventures. That's considered bad parenting now. It is so unusual for parents to let their children play outside, climb a tree, that they are being turned in as negligent instead of...
And no other culture does this. I mean, this is completely backwards from everything we do. This even happens in rural areas. I've had families on who've had their kids taken because they let them play in the backyard. I'm talking about 5 and 6 years old with a fence around them. That's not even allowed now.
That's incredible. I do hear I'm just going to give you a couple of examples. The one that you wrote about was a mom who has 4 kids. They were outside playing in the field next to her home, not at night with no clothes on. They were next to her house during the day, sunny Saturday weekend day. And it was so unusual these days to see any children outside. The immediate assumption is something's wrong. They've escaped. Maybe they've been kidnapped by somebody. Who knows? Or could be kidnapped. That's the big fear. And so the police were called, and then the police had to come and actually do a report. One person who wrote to me with a similar situation said that the husband who came out to talk to the cops was later made to take a drug test. Because why would any parent except one who's crazed on, I don't know, meth or coke or something, even think of letting his kids...
And again, they then intimidate you into the drug test, getting you into the bureaucratic system. But let's expand on this. You're coming on my show. You're going to get dozens of emails and calls. They take kids now. And what's incredible is, even as the Justice Department admits, CPS that you liken to Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda's not half as deadly, you know, statistically... hundreds of kids a year die in their custody. You're five times more likely to be physically abused or die, seven times to be sexually abused in CPS. So, oh, your kid might get kidnapped, so we're going to come kidnap them with an industry that's even more dangerous than, you know, perverts getting into the priesthood or TSA. I mean, this is where predators go, is CPS. So now they actually come kidnap your kid because they might get kidnapped.
I actually think that parents are ending up, in a way, kidnapping their kids, too, because if your fear is so overblown that the minute your kids walk outside, some predator is going to jump on them, because that's exactly what you see on Nancy Grace and CSI, you know, whether it's fiction or not, that's the number one story on television. You're so afraid of them being kidnapped, it almost seems like the only thing you can do to keep your kids safe is to keep them inside where they're going to the refrigerator and they're watching TV.
Well, this is a great example because I know you have the statistics on your excellent site. I mean, if you have them in front of you, go over some of that. But kidnapping's actually flat or gone down compared to what it was. But they make such a big deal, just like with terrorism, that it creates the perception that they're kidnappers around every corner.
Right. It's same as like, you know, you don't report on the millions of children who went safely to school today. You report on the one child, perhaps it's the anniversary of a child 30 years ago who didn't get to school. But there's always that one story that the media can find and put in front of our faces. And then our brains put it in, you know, in the file system, which is like Google. If you ask yourself, gee, can my kid walk to school? I actually got that question today to a lady writing to my site. Can my child walk to school? The principal says it's too dangerous. I can see the school from my house, but the principal says no.
They're turning everything into a prison.
Right.
I mean, it's very simple. The schools are prisons, and they're the nanny state is the prison.
Well, it does seem completely prison-like to say that you must drive your child or sometimes walk your child to school as if, you know, it's like walking across the yard.
Or put them on the school bus where they get beat up. But let's expand on that.
I don't think the school bus is that dangerous. I think what's really crazy is when people are all driving their children individually to school, wasting the gas, worrying about bullies, teaching them not how to get to school on their own, not to enjoy nature. But the only place you're safe is in an enclosed space, sometimes the SUV, with your parents and then deposited at
school. I'll tell you, the best thing ever happened to me was bullies. That made me the person I am. I love it. I mean, children have to learn to have some adventures.
Adventures is true. And also, while you don't want to, you know, encourage any horrible bullying, bullying has been like defined downward, dumbed down to the point where some schools have a list of things that that define bullying. And one of them is rolling your eyes at a kid. Come on.
Oh, but here's the deal. When you learn how to face bullies, then you know how to deal with them later in life. They don't want us knowing how to face bullies because the government acts like bullies. They want us to be cowards. When I see bullies now, I know how to deal with them.
Well, I'm glad you do. And I do believe that kids are a lot stronger and more resilient than we give them credit for. And when we think that they can't handle anything, that's when we say, no, you can't walk to school. No, you can't roll your eyes. Remember that story a couple days ago, the three-year-old whose name was Hunter, but he's deaf? Did you hear about this
one? Oh, he can't point his finger now.
He can't make the sign for his name, which is Hunter. This is Hunter, and this means it's a name. But that is too scary at the deaf school for preschoolers that he's going to because it indicates a gun. And somehow that gets conflated with somebody bringing an actual Uzi in to the school.
No, they're putting us into a total mental illness. They're making people mentally ill in basket cases and trying to artificially invoke and create artificial agoraphobia.
Exactly, especially where it concerns kids. You know, when we were talking about this case today with the mother who had her four children outside who was visited by the police, recently there was a man who let his two kids, 9 and I think 6 or 7, play in a park, and he was arrested because he had left them there for almost 2 hours, and that was considered negligent. I think that's considered believing in your kids, believing in your community, and believing that you're a smart enough parent that you taught them, don't go off with strangers.
Unbelievable. Absolutely. Then they get no street smarts. We'll be right back.
Have you ever thought...
Well, Lenore Skenazy is an impressive lady. Just get a chance to talk to her. We're going to get her on the nightly news next week for 45 minutes. We can really get into detail. But freerangekids.wordpress.com, she's having a big effect, too, pointing out that we're prisoners. You drive through neighborhoods now or you're up in a high-rise building looking at other people's condos, and I'm at a party or something, and everything's glowing blue. No one's talking. My friend had a telescope, and I said, what do you see? And he goes, people watching television. Just 50 years ago, folks, you saw people playing chess, people fighting, people having sex. Because I've read books about how the culture's changed. You would see everything with a telescope. Now you see people watching television. It's killing our culture. But now, in just 50 years, it's evil to have your kids out in public. I've seen cases where an 11-year-old throws a fit. Mom kicks him out of the car a mile from home, makes him walk. My mother would kick me out of the car 5 miles from home if I was not doing what she said. I mean, obviously, she wouldn't do it in South Dallas. I mean, I could see the poor kids that are locked up in war zones, but, I mean, we lived in an affluent middle-class neighborhood. They're now arresting people. Please continue with some of the other key points.
Point out is that people are doing exactly what you say. They're keeping their kids inside. And I point out, like, the South Dallas idea. It's if your kids are in a terrible neighborhood and there's no alternative to keep them safe, keep them inside. But if you move to a neighborhood because you liked the neighborhood, why are you keeping them inside? You're acting as if you're in a war zone when you have the privilege of letting your kids go outside. But it is so rare that I don't know if you know about my holiday. It's been celebrated for 3 years now, called Take Our Children to the Park and Leave Them There Day. Alex, did you hear about that holiday ever?
Actually, I read about it on your site, and that's what we need. My dad, by the time he was 8 or 9 years old, would be put on the bus by himself. Put on planes, you know, I was when I was like 4 or 5 years old, sent to family. Mm-hmm. And he would get down there. And by the time he was like 12, he would go and work for the summer in Houston.
That's incredible. Yeah, because back then, I mean, not that I want to see child labor resurging in any bad way, but at least we thought that kids were competent and could add something to society as opposed to us just giving them and doing for them.
Well, all it does is arrest development. I watch policed cadets today. Who literally, it was like they had lobotomies. They couldn't swim, they couldn't talk. And this is what we've turned the public into, is these jellyfish.
Right, and the idea is that you're being a good parent because you're hovering over them and you're keeping them from harm. But really, the message they're getting is, I can't do anything without my parents. Their parents wait at the bus stop with their children in the mornings and make sure that they get on the bus, as if it's so dangerous to be there with three other kids waiting for the bus, as if they can't get on the bus, as if there's some danger between the bus stop and the bus. And the message kids are getting is, I'm in constant danger, and if my parents aren't here, something bad will happen to me. Thank goodness there's somebody smart and big.
Listen, this morning, mm-hmm. I mean, I took my children swimming. It didn't happen today, but I'll have my four-year-old, who swims great, mm-hmm. in like 3 foot of water, mm-hmm. Swimming, you know, 20 feet away from me, and people will come over and say, you need to do something. And these are adults that can hardly swim. I'm like, listen, there's lifeguards here, and she knows how to swim. She can swim better than you.
Right. I think that actually what Free Range Kids says is that our job as parents isn't to do everything for the kid, isn't to hold your kid up in the pool. It's to teach them the skills they need to be safe and independent. And one of them really is teaching your children how to swim. Teach your children not to go off with strangers. Teach your children how to cross the street safely, because you're not going to be there with them every minute. And the idea that you should be is really treating kids as the lowest common denominator generation ever seen.
Well, look, let's be honest about it. Everything that happened to black communities in the last 100 years has now been exported everywhere, where they put people in these compact cities, these reservations, just like Native American reservations were really prisoner of war camps. And they get them to the point now where everything I saw growing up in inner city neighborhoods, because I had friends in the inner city, where they were scared to go out, didn't know how to do anything, didn't know how to swim. That's now everybody. Everybody is now, it's like weird if you know how to do something. It's weird if you're not scared. We're becoming prisoners who don't know what to do. We need to be locked up and unlocked. That's our new culture.
It's interesting that you think of it as sort of ghetto culture. I think of it, for me, what resonates is the idea that we are treating children the way we treated women in the 1950s and early 60s, telling them, you can't leave the house. You have everything here. You should be happy with all the
No, no. Exactly. That's the mode of social control they did to black folks and people and women. I agree with you. It's now being exported onto everybody.
Right, as if nothing is safe. And then, of course, if you have a group of people who doesn't believe anything is safe, you can sell them anything. You can sell them tracking devices for their children. You can sell them a screaming backpack, which I just found out about. Did you know that there's a child carrier, you know, like that you put on your back and the kid can hang onto your shoulders and sort of be strapped in? That's good for children up to age 7.
Now the children can't walk. I've predicted that soon tying your shoelaces will mean you get the Pulitzer Prize. Thank you so much. We'll have you on next week. Amazing information. FreeRangeKids.wordpress.com. Coming up at the start of the next hour, ladies and gentlemen. Again, I'm Alex Jones, your host. Thank you for joining us. We're going to have for one segment the head editor over at the InfoWars magazine, Russell Dowden, in studio with us. The NSA, in front of everybody back there, 6 people in his big office, they're all in one big room, that he gets a call, and nobody talks, so he calls it back, and they say, hello, National Security Agency. And he checked the number, all of it. But guys, ahead of him coming, we got to do this due diligence again. We were supposed to get a photo of that, have it ready so we can show the photo of his phone with the number so everybody can use it. And we need to call that number again right now. And we need to check it like I did on the web, just double check that it is the NSA number. So I want to put that number in the computer, check it again, double check it that it's the PR number of the National Security Agency. Because this is a news issue. Because I would get these calls 10 years ago and call back and they would answer National Security Agency. And it's a form of harassment. And then if you don't get the message, then they call up and tell you what you're talking about on an unlisted number. And you know, oh, you got family in the hospital. I hope they don't do too good. Just heard you talking to your family. So that's the kind of, I mean, I've had crew see this happen when my wife calls up crying and they've done it to her. Okay. I mean, this is the type of stuff they do. This is what our country has become. This has happened everywhere else where you let government get too big and you start bowing down to it and just saying it's your God. We're going to be talking about this and my crew that went down, 3 of our crew members, 3 reporters, but John Bowne on camera in just a moment. Before we go any further, remember, freedom is not free, and we are risking our lives to bring you this information. We are doing everything we can to expose the globalist. I have hired 6 new reporters. I have hired 7 graphics people and writers and editors for the magazine, the websites. I just hired another writer on top of that, so I guess that's 8. I am expending our capital because it's all starting to come down. And so I'm doing everything I can so later I won't wish that I'd done more. You know the Braveheart speech? What would you do many years from now lying in your beds to just once say you can take our lives, but you'll never take our freedom? That's what we're talking about. And this isn't your life. If you won't fight in the info war today to get the word out, you'll never fight with a sword. That's a cop-out. You need to reach out to the minions of the system, and I'll tell you, on average, who are about as dumb as a box of rocks. And I'm talking about bureaucrats, all of them. Of minions, police generally are smarter because they live in the real world. Firefighters are great people. So I'm not saying the government's the enemy. The criminals that have seized it and are trying to direct it in a draconian, anti-American, anti-liberty, anti-freedom way must be exposed in the info war. So you can spread the word about the broadcast, spread the word about our free podcast, the audio streams, our local affiliates, if you're listening on local stations. You can purchase the books, the videos, the T-shirts, the ball caps. It takes over $5.5 million a year to run this operation now. Most people, and believe me, I could probably make almost that much money with like 6 people here, but not reach as many people. So I could sit here and, you know, make, you know, Glenn Beck type money if I wanted to sell out to the system right now, or if I just wanted to cut back what I'm doing. I'm taking the majority, the vast majority, 90%+ of the money and putting it right back into this operation, ladies and gentlemen. And then, of course, putting some back so we can be strong for frivolous whatever happens down the roads, lawsuits, attacks, fake criminal charges. We've got backup plans because we have a different mission. It's not make money. Our mission is fight the globalists, but we need the money. So in mid-air refueling, as I call it, on air, go to InfoWarsStore.com. InfoWarsShop.com takes you to the same place. Or link through at InfoWars.com. Buy books, buy videos, buy ball caps. Got my favorite camouflage ones back in. Couldn't get them for a while. Buy the Pro Pure super high-quality stainless steel gravity filters. They've got the extra fluoride filters as well. 10% off. Nobody's got that price with promo code WATER. That purchase is something you need. It's a great deal, and it supports us. InfoWarsStore.com. You're doing so much when you come and vote with your dollars and by spreading the word. InfoWarsStore.com. When you bought out 36,000 copies at cost of the new magazine, 50,000 on the streets of Austin, 40,000 I printed, 4,000 held back for when we start subscriptions next month, so you get the first issue plus the next 12. That's just amazing. Sold out of those, and a few places refused them, so we still have a few left there on the site. But the point is that I increased the price because actually sold them for too little and then lost money. So now I'm selling them for like $3 a piece instead of, you know, less than a dollar a piece like I was, because I ended up losing money. So there's a few of those September issues still left at InfoWarsStore.com because, again, 66 locations refused them out of 1,000 plus here in Austin. So, but they're almost gone. They're probably gone as of the time I say this. The point is that's how we fund ourselves. So get excited about funding liberty. And if you don't have, you know, a pot to do you know what in, it doesn't matter. Spread the word about the local AM and FMs. Spread the word about the websites. Spread the word about the information. I know we can beat these people. We've beaten tyrants before. We will defeat them if we absolutely go up against them and call them out for what they are. Okay, you think it intimidates me when the NSA calls up? I love it. Okay, if they strike me down in the fight against tyranny, it means I did a good job. I don't want to die, but I don't want them to win and enslave us. And it's that commitment, that spiritual decision to set your weight spiritually, mentally, physically, intellectually, economically against the enemy that will bring them down. We will bring them down, but it's up to you to support us at InfoWarsStore.com and also become sponsors of our local AM and FM affiliates. Okay. Now, shifting gears here, we have John Bound, who's been with us for a year, done a great job, formerly worked at a local TV station here and in radio before that. And we have Linda West, who's now been here for about a week or less and already hit the ground running, writing articles, doing reports, man on the street coming out, you name it. She's worked in TV, radio, print, run newspapers. She's now part of the team, just amazing team. We now have 6 new reporters here. Well, one of them's coming in a few weeks. So we have 5 new reporters on top of the 3 or 4 we've got, all because of you supporting us, okay? Thank you so much. So we can get more stories, more reports. I'm so sick of not being able to cover everything in detail I want, and it just becomes a scatterbrained event. We are expanding in the face of the globalist, in the face of their takeover, in the face of their attacks, and others, the inventor of the internet, not Al Gore, has come out and said it's a total tyranny we're facing. Others are recognizing that we've been right and that, yes, it's happening. We've got a good chance of turning this around. They wanted to go down and talk about the TSA and the national story that we're in AP, Reuters, CBS News about our report about them dipping the testers in coffee and food you buy past the checkpoint. They politely show up. They all know who we are. And they freak out. The police come over. They say, don't leave. Well, am I detained? No, but don't leave. The TSA goons. All of this, like, we're bad to have cameras. And here's the deal. They're arresting people nationwide for owning guns, okay? They're arresting people nationwide for owning guns and things, which aren't even illegal, that people are now open carrying to exercise that right. It's the same thing with cameras. They're arresting people nationwide for filming police in public areas. People have to counter that with lawsuits and speech and all of it. They're going to take our basic rights. They're trying to. They are becoming tyrannical. And just because they're wearing a uniform doesn't mean they're God, folks. This is how North Korea fell. This is how all the other countries went into darkness. Guys, great job. Dan Badani's a big part of this, but he's in there running the show right now. John Bound first, then Linda West. Give us a breakdown of what you witnessed and what we're about to see in this video.
Well, we basically went over to the airport to get a bird's eye view of the airport because, you know, everyone has their own qualms about going to the airport and talking to the people that work there because it's so scary there. But I've had it. I'm done. I'm tired of the New World Order pushing the agenda of my life around. I'm done with it. So I said, let's just go upstairs. Let's confront the dragon. Let's go talk to the TSA.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, so evil. Talking to our God?
Yeah. Well, and I brought this vampire killer thing with me. It's called the Bill of Rights and the Constitution. And Dan Bedondi, the vampire killer, wielding it, as you'll see in the video. But when you show the Bill of Rights to somebody...
The cop actually recoiled. He, like, looked at it like, oh, because they teach him disdain for it now.
Well, it's like shoving a vampire into the noonday sun. They're like, well, maybe that's right, but wait, I got all this power. Well, let me get a hold of my power. Hang on. Let me check.
You know, I got a gun.
Call some people and check on my power.
And there's some terrorists in the area.
We just had it. We just threw them in the InfoWars blender, and we all just went off on the DHS, the Homeland Security media representative.
Well, they're not even police. They have no training.
Who are these people?
Well, they had an eight-hour course. They can read your mind.
Done.
Good. Hey, Linda, tell us your take on this.
Well, you know, after that story came out about the LAPD going after people that take pictures in the airport, of course we said...
Well, it wasn't even in the airport. They're now on the streets. They're grabbing them.
I know, on the streets. But when I called the commanding officer, he said in particular, you'll get arrested if you videotape at the airport.
So, but there's no law.
Right. There's no law. As you said, there's no law.
You can look it up. It's just they're false arresting. They're disappearing people.
It's fear. They're trying to get us with fear.
And the answer is no, bully, no.
That's right. That's right, Alex. And so we said, well, of course, well, let's go down to the airport then, because they haven't made that law yet in Austin. So we got down there and everybody was kind of up in arms. The TSA guys kept walking by and I kept saying, oh, can I have a comment? And they're like, no, we can't talk to you. I'm like, well, why can't you talk to me? What do you mean you can't talk to me?
You're a slave.
Yeah. It's like,
well, talk to American scum. Pay my paycheck. Pay the security fee, scum American. Get over here for a grope. They're probably like, we'll get you guys next time.
Yeah, yeah. She's like, hey, you know, last time I was here, I went through the airport, I got groped. And this is a tyrannical area. And
you're supposed to lay down to that, though.
The guy's like, I think this is a great place.
Yeah, I like it.
Someone said, hey, have you had your groping today? You want one? I mean, you'll see in the video. I'm done.
And Linda, anything else?
Yeah, then they all come over. Like, first they're like, well, we've got to get the manager. And I'm like, okay. And then the manager comes walking over. And that was the best part, because he comes over and he's like trying to be all, you know, fear-inducing. And we're just like, what's wrong?
They are now at the DNC. Peaceful protesters are being arrested. And they're calling protesting, before they even get out of their car, low-level terrorism, and say, oh, hold them because we put them on a list. That's the new thing. I'm government. I'm God. You're on a list. Your property's mine. Your kids are mine. I'm God. I'm Kim Jong-il. And I'm like, no, you're not. No, you're not. No, you're not.
Right to assembly. First Amendment. Hey, anybody read anymore?
Everybody ever heard of George Washington? Stick it. Stick it. You got it? We're America. Not you. Let's go ahead and go to the report. Here it is. We will go to that exciting report.
Nice to meet you.
I don't want this on right now. All right.
Okay.
We're not going to talk on camera. I got to talk to you offline.
Offline?
Offline. You got that?
Why? Why are you upset? Aren't you the media?
No, I'm just coming to see. I understand that you're talking to some of our officers.
I wanted to ask some questions about the TSA.
We have a process where you come through the media office at this airport. Yeah. Everybody follows it. KXAN.
That's why I asked for you.
Everybody.
That's why I asked for you.
I'm not a PIO for the airport. There's a PIO for the airport. I represent TSA.
That's who I wanted to talk to. I wanted to talk to the PIO for TSA.
You just don't talk to me like this. We've got some other processes where we go through the PIO.
Well, why?
Can you guarantee us an interview?
No, not right now.
I'm sorry.
I mean, if you call the head, that'd be fine. You know, maybe we could work some money.
Okay. You know, we're just Americans. We're just trying to get the story.
You just can't.
Yeah, but it shouldn't be like that in America.
This is America.
We should be able to talk to each other.
You work for Homeland Security?
Freedom of the press. First.
Okay. You work for Homeland Security?
The bottom line is that. The bottom line is the First Amendment, Jack.
Yeah, the First Amendment, sir.
They could call the videos and all this
other stuff. The what?
The officers, the police officers.
Oh.
So we don't want that.
You know, okay.
Sir, the thing is, you're a public official. A public official has to answer in public. This is the First Amendment of the Constitution.
You're
a federal agency.
What are you going to do to me?
I'm not going to do anything to you.
You have to answer the question in public.
We were just wanting to know, as fellow Americans. I got 300 million guys,
man.
Well, you know, we're reporters. We're just trying to ask people questions.
You got to be professional.
That's why we ask you.
So your job is to basically come up, tell people that you can't help.
This is the airport. And again, there is a process.
You guys didn't follow the process.
The process to exercise the First Amendment. We're in a sorry, could you show me in the Constitution where it says we have to follow process?
It didn't used to be like this.
Well, we know.
I used to be able to run on the plane, hug people. Well, I got grilled last time I came through, and I don't think
well, we know the State Department put the underwear bomb on the plane. That's on record, sir. How you doing, sir? Sir, the First Amendment says we don't need permission.
Yes, you do.
It's the First Amendment. Sir,
Airport
do you write the Constitution?
Airport 17, TSA request.
So the airport police take orders from the TSA, federal government.
You have to have permission to film at the airport here. You can film as long as you go through the PIO, and they give you authorization to do it.
Authorization to exercise the First Amendment, sir?
No, just want. So
why do you guys got to follow orders by Homeland Security? I mean, you're the authority here, not Homeland Security.
I'm not following orders.
But they're the ones who summoned you.
They have a right to follow me to a
phone. Absolutely.
Like
but I mean,
any private
but
citizen does.
They're the ones who summoned you for this occasion here. And you, as a law-abiding citizen, sir, you took an oath upon the Constitution to defend it. And which
know what I took it.
You did. Every officer does. I have many family who are airport police in Providence, Rhode Island, and people who are the state police as well. You take an oath upon the Constitution to have that badge upon your chest, sir. And the Constitution is to defend the Constitution and its republic, not take orders from these tyrannical people with Homeland Security.
They're tyrannical people.
They are, sir. It's on record. It's on record. These guys put the State Department put the underwear bomb on the plane.
Obviously, you want to be confrontational.
No, not at all.
Yes, you do.
I'm just trying to address you as a citizen to citizen.
That's
all.
You can't do.
We didn't do that, sir.
Okay. You went up to one of their BDOs,
not
and he didn't want to ask your questions.
Yeah, and we respected that.
We didn't. For a PIO.
Yeah, all we asked is for a PIO, a public information officer. That's all we asked for. And by law, they have to have one.
Well, we gotta
these people don't have authorization to film here.
Oh, okay.
Do you want to tell them the proper process?
Yes, sir.
What you got to do in order to film here?
Is you're going to have to call our dispatch. You got to get with the proper individuals to be able to film here at the airport.
I'm not that. That's rude.
Sir, this is a constitution of the United States right here.
I see your driver's license.
Anywhere, I don't have to show my ID, sir.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't, sir.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't. It's my constitutional right.
Let me see your driver's license.
I don't have it on me. And the Constitution of the United States says, shall not be infringed. Freedom of speech. Do you write the Constitution? I'm not being confrontational. I'm just standing up here as an American that wants to defend my civil liberties and my rights, sir. And to film in a public place is my taxpayers pay for this airport. Your salaries as well.
Is Jason available?
Jason, I can give you a phone number where you can try to reach Jason.
Okay.
I can definitely do that.
All right. That'd be great.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Let's write
here,
that down.
I'll write it down. Do you know it off your head or you got to
yes,
go
somewhere?
Oh, okay. Thank you.
And nothing against you personally, sir. I'm just defending the Constitution that you probably served when you were in the military, if you were.
Yeah,
that's all we wanted, sir.
Yeah,
we just asked.
No, you're being totally confrontational.
We got it all on video,
being
sir.
Totally confrontational.
No, I'm just defending my rights as
you're
a citizen.
Being totally confrontational.
No, I'm not, sir.
We'll get out of here, guys.
You don't have that right here at this point.
And nobody
so
should be
saying
American.
All right, that's good.
All right, guys.
We're going to post the full video later. I'm going to air it all in the nightly news tonight. Aaron's doing the news. I'm doing a couple interviews. We're going to have Dan Bedondi, who was doing a fabulous job, as well as other reporters there. Now, to be clear, he's got the microphone about 3 feet away from the guy. They're calling that confrontational. And what they do is they target moms when they're strip searching their five-year-old in front of everybody. You've seen the films. They tell them, I'll take you to prison. It's illegal to film us. It's not. They'll say, we got to do the proper policy. This is even up at the checkpoint. This is just in the airport going and asking near the offices, hey, where John Bowne's been many times working for KXAN, local, what is that, ABC?
It's NBC.
Yeah, NBC. I mean, many, many times working here locally. So that's why he knew the name of the guy. The mainstream media just struts him whenever they want. But citizens and alternative media and real media, it's like, I'll take you to jail. And in Illinois, they tried to give people, one guy, life in prison for filming police. He beat him in court. The state came back in wanting charges and tried to put him in jail. They want to put you in jail when you show what they're doing. They want to film you. They want to have the NSA illegally tap your phone 24/7 in live time, as their whistleblowers admit. But you aren't going to go when they're groping you or state reps are being groped and get angry. you're not going to go film them. And it's all color of law. And the cops show up and say, you know, give me your ID. Don't leave. Well, am I detained? No, you're not, but don't leave, which is a custodial arrest, which is only a citizen's arrest power. And then cities and counties hire police professionally to act in that as a citizen's arrest. And then as a citizen, you get a bond. You get a bond. But see, they just want, your kids aren't playing outside. You aren't going anywhere. We're going to give you shots when we want. You're going to drink fluoride. You're going to submit to us 110%. So that's what this is about. It's about us saying, no, we're going to film you. And I don't even know. I told you guys to go do Man on the Street. You just went over there yesterday. So I'm really glad you did that. Any closing comments on that?
I just want to say, folks out there, civil disobedience, the time is now. Go read the Bill of Rights. Go find that petty tyrant in your community and exercise your American right.
Well, I am going to call for another protest where nationwide we film the TSA. Nationwide we go protest the NSA. It's time to stop being scared of these people. Yeah. Yep. If they're able to scare us, they're taking over.
They have no power. They've
set up re-education camps. It's now official.
They really tried to scare us. The first thing he did was start calling for backup. And I said to him, you know what? I'm going to call 911 and have this recorded and ask for your training officer to come out here because I'm feeling really harassed now and I'm not doing anything.
No, Linda, you're supposed to, when you fly back and forth from here from L.A. where you got your business, you're supposed to just let them grab you and let them put you in microwave ovens. You're supposed to like it. I'm supposed to like it. I can't take my kids on a plane ride or go somewhere because I won't let men grab their genitals. I'm supposed to think that's normal.
Ridiculous. Just ridiculous. And I interviewed one woman and I said, do you think women like this, really attractive women, I said, do you think it's okay that they're groping our bodies, that we're even a possible threat?
The new documents that they blocked for 2 years coming out, the four-year letters show the thousands of letters where they go in the pants of women. And I can't even say this on air. I mean, Miss USA, they actually went in her. They're now removing tampons out of women. Saying, what is this? What the hell do you think it is? What will we put up with? We're such a joke.
You know what? We're going to win, Alex. We're going to win all this. And all you people that have done this, you're going to be arrested. Yep. Because my kids aren't going to deal with this in their future. Right. I'm thinking about my kids right here.
We're done. We're done. We know you ran 9/11. We know you did it, murderers. It's over.
And they backed down. Those cops.
You want to call me some more NSA?
They got scared.
They did. The three of us together and Dan with like the Constitution.
Good. They're gonna.
Guy's like, you don't know what oath I took. He's like, I know what oath you took. You're wearing the badge. You had to take the oath.
They don't. They'll find out. Look. They think they have a status and we're second class. We're American scum. We pay the bills. That's what they see us as. We are nothing but their slaves. And it's over. We're off the plantation. It's over. You got the message? I hope you do. If you support the Republic, then you're our friend. But if you say George Washington's bad like the police training manuals do, you're an enemy collaborator with the foreign banks. We're going to have you all back on the Nightly News tonight. Great job. Because that we can get three people in that studio. Thank you. There they go. All right, I'm shifting gears now to gold. Gold has exploded massively today. He hadn't been on for months. We predicted as the fall started it would go up. They're talking about QE3. I believe now, I just bought some last week, just a few silver, a few gold, is the time to buy gold and silver. I believe now is the time to get yourself prepared. I believe it's only going to go up as they globally devalue the dollar and other major currencies that they're devaluing in unison. And Ted's got gold he bought at the old lower prices, even though gold's way up today. And he's got a bunch of other specials. Ted Anderson, owner of Genesis Communications, the gold company that I had as a sponsor before. You know, you even had a radio network that I sought out, a really good, reputable company. And here you are with the best deals I know of out there on the bullion, especially. Ted Anderson, tell us what you got today. Give us the offer.
Well, I mean, the ECB bonds was what's driving the market, Alex. And what we have going on right now, the offers that we have are going to be the Frank coin at 372. We have Walking Liberty halves at 1574. The Lakota silver rounds, a lot of people still like those. They're 4096. Canadian Maple Leafs. Also a very good coin to be getting into. We got the U.S. Eagles. Currently right now, Canadian Maple Leafs are trading at 1859.75. But there's a lot of things that are going on, Alex, right now. And you're right about that. We're in the fall now. The news that's coming out in the marketplace actually makes a difference. For some reason in the summer, everybody's lulled to sleep. Now we're starting to see it happen. We have gold over $1,700 an ounce. Gold is up today, $10.20, and we've already seen $1,715 an ounce. And, you know, that's just the beginning. We're just coming into this. So, yeah, if you're going to be getting in, moving in on gold and silver, you better take your action now, because even silver right now at $32.75, that's up 38 cents today. And, you know, we've been talking about QE3. Well, what's going on in Europe? Well, that is QE3. They're talking about bailing out all these, you know, hurting countries. Well, you know, all that means is they're going to do is they're going to turn on the printing presses, and they're taking and they're following the lead of the United States.
What are the best gold and silver bullion prices you've got? What should people call and get right now?
Well, what I would do, if you're looking for something right now, I'd look for the Canadian Maple Leaf currently at this particular time, just due to the fact that that coin is 999 fine. It's 1859.75. Of course, there's volume discounts right now at this particular coin. For those of you who have been very concerned, been hearing a lot about confiscation, that type of thing, you can get into the $20 gold pieces right now at this particular time at 2045. But again, Alex, I think the most important thing is you take action, get involved now.
I agree, Chad. Let me fire out the Midas Resources number. I want to go to break, come back for 5 minutes with you and talk about some of the economic numbers, QE3, 800-686-2237, and the tiny profit they make goes right back into the GCN Radio Network, GCNlive.com, 800-686-2237. And some of their best deals are linked to the right-hand corner at Infowars.com. That's MidasResources.com. MidasResources.com or 800-686-2237. The next hour, straight ahead. All right, Ted Anderson, decades in the gold and silver business. MidasResources.com, 800-686-2237. He's joining us right now, just briefly, ahead of the NSA report we're going to give you coming up in the next segment. Ted, I mean, look, you read the financial news. They're starting to lean towards QE3. I'm surprised they haven't gone to it yet. I'm not saying go to it, but if they don't, things will really implode. But if they do QE3, they'll have hyperinflation that'll lead to an implosion. So we're in trouble either way. But obviously, they drove down gold artificially. That even came out in the news, manipulating paper, engaging in fraud. But they can't hold it down forever. I mean, that's why I've held on to gold I bought at $300 and gold I bought at $1,900. Just because they drove it down a few hundred bucks, I didn't panic, because it's an emergency backup. I don't buy it for an investment, even though it's been one of the best performing. And it's now time to get gold and silver. But in the 3 or 4 minutes we've got here, why is gold starting to rocket up? And why have you told me privately you thought it would go up in the fall? Well, you've said that publicly.
Well, I mean, it typically does. I mean, usually in the summertime, we see our low point, and usually in the fall, coming even towards the end of the year, we see our peak. And this year is like the average year. I mean, there was a couple of years ago when we had TARP, TARP money that was being asked for, and we had a great summer, and the fall was fantastic too in gold. But right now, you're seeing all this. The problems in the United States and the problems in Europe have not gone away. Gold went down to about $1,550 an ounce, but we still had all the fundamental reasons why people should buy gold. Although when it's going down, people back away from it. Now we're in the fall, and for some reason, you know, just quantitative easing in Europe all of a sudden triggers gold to go up in price at this time of year. You'll see gold rise. It won't be surprising to me to see $2,000 an ounce gold now, because the last peak was at 1900. We're at 1704.60. We've come up off of 1550. Silver right now at 3275, coming up from $26. I mean, that's a really nice increase. But I got to tell you, the future right now is still ahead of us, because we're still sitting in September. We've got October to November, December. I mean, the elections, you think that the elections are going to solve this problem, and it's just not.
The globalists are digging in like it's the end of the world, Ted. I got to get you on the nightly news for like a full hour where we don't have commercials except the start and the end, to really go over all the numbers and Soros buying gold, and all these other big globalists are buying it while telling the public not to buy it, because they know it exposes the fact that their fiat currency is dying while they scurry, and while universities buy billions of it like UT. I believe now is the time to get gold and silver. And folks, call and ask for the Alex Jones radio specials. They've got a whole list of stuff at the lower price. It's already gone up. You regularly call and it goes up. That's how you make money in gold and silver, is buy when it's low, sell when it's high. You know, free market. We're not communist. But Ted will hold the price down. How long can you hold the price down, Ted?
I'm going to be doing it today. And I can tell you one of the things that I have right now, I still have the $63 book you know, if the two DVDs and the book, or the book and DVD and the two silver dollars for $63 shipped to your doorstep, you're not going to buy silver dollars for that price anymore.
Yeah, you get the free, and they're almost sold out, the Big Brother book that's excellent, paralleling 1984. And then we also have the American Dream DVD about the banking system. Great way to wake up newbies. It's a cartoon. Very well produced. Hilarious as well. A little adult, a little racy for folks. Probably not good to show small children. I mean, tiny. Folks will watch it and won't think it's racy. But the point is, it could be racy for some people. You get those free with the two silver dollars at cost. And that's the Big Brother special. There's a link at Infowars.com or go to MidasResources.com to find that. 800-686-2237. 800-686-2237. And it looks like we're starting to go back into another bull market in precious metals. So get in now, in my view. I know that's what I'm doing. 800-686-2237. The place, Midas Resources. MidasResources.com to find the some of the radio specials. But for a full list, tell them Alex Jones sent you. Thank you, Ted Anderson.
Yeah, thanks, Alex.
We'll be back. Why is the NSA calling our office? Stay with us. If you go up to Infowars.com, you'll see articles by Paul Joseph Watson linking through the London Telegraph, where the different inventors of the Internet have gotten together and written public letters saying that a new dark age of tyranny is upon us. That governments are spying on us en masse. The one man that most scientists agree came up with the idea for the Internet still looks young, even though this came up with these ideas in the 70s. Sir Tim Berners-Lee accuses government of draconian Internet snooping. He doesn't accuse him. It's admitted. And he goes on to say that there is a giant web of government invasion and monitoring the web. Well, I mean, the British government admits they're doing that. Web inventor warns government Internet has no off switch. He says, you're not going to stop us. He's never been a political guy. And there's all these other people coming out. There are new NSA whistleblowers just every few days that are coming out and saying, hey, we're listening to everything. We've got hubs and everything. The FBI agent just got caught with 12 million Apple IDs, and of course they denied it. Folks, they've under the Telecommunications Act, they're wired into everything. They're dialing in. Now, going back about 10 years ago, I occasionally would get a call at home or a call on the cell phone. It would say no number available, or it would just be zeros, or there'd be no number. And then I would call the number back because nobody would talk, and they would say National Security Agency, and I'd say, you just called me. They're like, may we help you? You know, this is a government agency. What is the name? What is the extension? And I would go check the number and find out it was the NSA. And my phone would turn off and stuff when this happened. It's like when they call you, it does some order for computers to take it over. That's what I thought. It's obviously harassment, because then later, I've had a few of these calls. My wife's had even more than I have, where a woman calls up and says, your husband got me pregnant. Your husband gave me a disease. Your husband, I mean, it's different stories. And then she'll say, no, he didn't. That's not true. And they'll say, well, we're going to get you. And we saw your little dog in the backyard. That's a nice dress you were wearing. Or they'll say, hey, we heard you talking to your mommy or your daddy. You know, I'm glad they're in the hospital. So they'll call right after you're talking to family. And always at an emotional point, they're waiting to trigger fear in you. They're waiting in the psyop till you get the news that your dad's in the hospital, your mom's in the hospital, and that's when the whoever it is tapping our phones. Because there's 15 agencies doing it, and there's hundreds of private contractors. There's the Total Information Awareness Network, where they came out in the New York Times and said, we're listening to everything you do, everything you buy. And there was a backlash, and they said, okay, Admiral Poindexter's off that job, the felon. Now, who got pardoned, but then it came right back. So they admit they've got it to intimidate us, but then when we talk about it, they then back off. Okay, so that's what's going on. That's what's happening here. That's what's unfolding. Now, Russell Dowden, I've known Russell 12 years. He's a no-nonsense guy. For over a decade, he had Weird Magazine. I've now bought it. We're going to republish it down the road. But I knew he'd put out successfully a monthly publication. And I liked him. And so I went ahead and said, you know, we're going to pull the trigger. We're going to launch InfoWars Magazine. And it's been a huge success. Now, he gets a call yesterday right after I walk out of the office. I come back in. He goes, look, and it says called. And we have a screenshot of that we'll put on screen. And the NSA called him. And in, then when he called it back, you know what? We may have to blow your phone up here on air and actually show people. Just give it to me. Okay, we blew it up so everybody can see it. There is the mobile call number on his new AT&T Droid phone. And Russell's going to talk to us here in just a moment. And that is the call that he got. In fact, you showed me the call history. There's actually a area in there that shows, you know, the region it came from. It shows that it, you know, they called you. Can I see your phone? I want to show people the part where it says they called you. That was the data sheet that I wanted to show people. We'll just show people watching on PrisonPlanet.tv. If not, if you're on the radio listening to this, you can, yeah, just pull it up where I can see that, because that's Will Jones and other people. Yeah, yeah, just pull that up for me. We're going to do this right now here on air. So the issue is, I want people to see that the call history, the NSA called you, and the number we just showed on screen, if you're a radio listener, we're streaming video. Again, by tomorrow, this will be posted for everybody at Infowars.com, is the NSA. And we called it yesterday. We called it again today. It's the National Security Agency. We checked the number online. It's the NSA. So they've done this to me before. So, Russell, you're probably going to get, you know, the phone call. I know your stepdad's got cancer. If you get the call, he dies. God forbid. That's when they'll hit you. I just want to warn you. Yep. That's when they'll call. Because, again, they want to terrorize you, and they think that's the point where they'll freak you out. And, again, this is who runs our country. This is who's listening to our phones. This is what they do. And while we're digging that out, Russell, tell folks the story. Let me see it. You find it?
I've got it. I've got it queued up for you right there, Alex.
Yeah, I'll cover the other numbers. You've got a whole history here as well, because I don't want to show people everybody else's numbers. And we'll do another video on the nightly news about this. This is kind of helter-skelter. Yeah. But there it is. Guys, show me a document cam shot of that if you can. NSA, okay, 301-688-6524. And we're going to call that on air here in just a moment. Tell people about your new phone. tell people about the call. Tell them what happened.
Well, yesterday, Alex, I was making some calls. I'm always dealing with advertising back there. So, you know, I'm making calls. And I received a call on my cell phone that I answered, but no one said anything. It was just like static, and I heard a few beeps and clicks. I thought, okay, hello. Well, I figured, I'll call this number back eventually, and I got some other calls came in for business, for advertising stuff. And so then I decided, let me go ahead and call that number back. Maybe it was maybe an advertiser or somebody. Maybe I just had a bad connection. So I called it back, and it's National Security Agency, Public Awareness Office. Can I help you? And I'm like, I thought I was calling. I made a phone call the other day, the NRA. I thought I was calling back the NRA, you know, because I made a call to them. Well, no, it turns out she says, no, this is the National Security Agency. How can I help you? And I'm like, oh, well, I was just returning a phone call. And, no, sir, you know, this is the National Security Agency. You must have the wrong number. Oh, okay. Well, all right. Well, thank you. And, you know, I kind of hung up, freaked me out. I was like, whoa. Now, there's the weirdest call I've had.
And then I came back in and we...
Yeah, you had just left when I returned that call, because that call came in before you came in. And then I returned the call just as you left. And, I couldn't believe it was, you know, okay, so apparently now, you know, National Security Agency has got my cell phone number.
And how... Well, of course, they're listening right now, probably. They can dial in even when the phone's off and listen. That's why when Bush would get people on Air Force One, everyone had to take the batteries out and put them in a bag. Yeah. And they admit, other governments can dial in and listen to these because we built back doors in them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just totally criminal, by the way. Each act of this is a felony. But they just don't care. They just they grope small children. That's a felony.
Yeah.
And when the state of Texas says we're going to stop you, they say, no, we're going to arrest you. All right, let's go ahead and dial this number here on air in this jam-packed show today. We're going to call the NSA number that we've called last night back twice and today twice, and we checked the number online. This is the NSA, the National Security Agency, there outside of Washington, D.C. Okay, here they are, or maybe it's the new one in San Antonio. Maybe it's the new one in outside Salt Lake City.
I believe it was Fort Meade, Maryland.
NSA Public Affairs, how can I help you?
Ma'am, did you say NSA Public Affairs?
Yes, I did.
Listen, I get phone calls occasionally from you guys at home and on my phone. And then my sales manager, a general manager of my national publication, InfoWars Magazine, and I'm a syndicated radio talk show host, he got a call from the number. When he called it back, it's the NSA. Can you tell us who we need to talk to about the NSA that's calling us?
Hold on 1 second.
Right, because sometimes they're not very friendly calls. You know, I hope your dad dies, you know, very nice people. Because, you know, they like to let you know they're listening. It's good people. We're the bad guys because we don't like this. You know, mom, apple pie, George Washington, freedom. We're the bad guys. Yeah, that's us. We don't run Al-Qaeda like the Pentagon publicly does, or Amir al-Awlaki or all these guys. You know, we're bad men.
Yeah, terrorists.
Yeah, we're bad. I mean, you know, so here we are. Hello, NSA. Hello, we're here. We know you're already listening anyways. That's the whole point of this phone call. They're already listening. They're listening to radio. They're listening to the transmissions. They're listening to us on XM. They're listening on your cell phone right now.
Yeah, they can hear us right now. Just tapped in right now.
Good afternoon. How may I help you?
Hi, ma'am. Is this, who is this with the NSA? I'm Alex Jones, transmitting worldwide. Broadcasting worldwide. Your number keeps calling me and calling crew members of our office. We can give you the phone records of that. Why is the NSA calling us?
Sir, the National Security Agency isn't calling you.
Oh, we're imagining it? Just like we were imagining you're spying on everybody without warrants?
Sir, you contacted the National Security Agency. Is there something I can do for you?
Well, I guess you control reality, like Karl Rove said, ma'am. You won't tell us your name. I'm Alex Jones. We're telling you.
Alex, first of all, let's stop. You never even gave me a chance to really tell you who I was, if I was going to answer your question or not. Again, happy to help, but if you're...
Well, you're very sweet, ma'am. Well, thank you. Then let's start over. I'm broadcasting worldwide right now.
Okay.
The NSA called one of my newspaper general manager's number. It was dead air with beeping. He called him back, and then they said, no, we didn't call you, but we have the phone. We have the record.
Okay, sir. I wasn't the one that took that call. I have no way of knowing. Happy to take your information and happy to have it looked into.
Oh, please. Well, okay, I've got to go off here. I don't want to give you my... Well, I guess you've already got my number. Can't you just have the guys call me? I mean, they're already listening right now. You
can call my number.
You've got Russell Dowden's number here in Austin, Texas. Can you just ask whoever just calling him to give us another call, tell us their name?
I don't actually have your number. You just called me. Again, happy to take the information and have it looked into.
Well, you're very sweet, ma'am, and I know you're... I mean, what are you, just an operator or a public relations person?
Oh, no, I'm a public affairs officer.
Well, that's very nice of you. We're going to go to break here then, and I will give you my cell phone number, though the NSA doesn't need it. So we're going to go to break right here. I'm going to talk to you off air and give you my number, and maybe we can get your name and stuff. And it would be very nice if someone would call me back so we can... Well, you already have the phone record. I want to find out who's either spoofing the number or if the NSA is calling me, because I also get other calls.
HempUSA.org.
Her name was Lavina. Yeah. So go ahead and turn Russell on. We're back live. Got in-studio guests coming up. The children now wearing satellite trackers, RFID trackers. They have Pentagon cameras in San Antonio as well that watch the kids eat their food. Because the Pentagon wants to know how they eat their food. That's Associated Press, if you think I'm joking. It's no big deal. I mean, everything's fine. Nothing to worry about. It's like they say in Caddyshack, you know, nothing to worry about, Mr. Governor, just a harmless animal, not plastic explosives or anything. You know, everything's fine. The government's arming itself the teeth, 1.4 billion bullets. We just talked to that lady, and she said her name was Lavina, public information officer. Everyone's an officer but us. Yeah. It's a new class thing. We're just scum citizen. But she was nice. And I was like, well, you know, somebody could be spoofing this if it's not you, you know, your office calling. Probably somebody in the NSA or somebody in their private database spoofing us. And I'm trying to tell the NSA this is going on.
Yeah, well, we gave them our number, my number, and
the time they called.
And the time they called, they already had the number.
Actually, pull that up again. You've got the whole list of your calls back to them, too.
Yeah.
You've got the incoming. The incoming was actually at 12:30-something.
Yes, let me find
it. And then you never called it back till later, so that's why you figured it out like 4 o'clock.
Yeah. I figured it out about 3 or 4 o'clock, we realized.
Well, let me see it. You just had the whole call history pulled up.
Let's see here. Let's sign it.
What did you think of that conversation?
Creepy. Creepy that they got my number. We gave them my number again just to make sure that they had the right number. And again, Lavina from the NSA, very polite lady, but we had to give her my number so that she knew the right number to look up and why they called and to see, you know, what the deal is. I mean, I don't know. Apparently, I'm a terrorist now and running the magazine over here at InfoWars. And yeah. Gotta get after me there, I guess, Alex.
Well, you work somewhere where we got George Washington hanging on the wall, pal.
Yeah, I'm an evil terrorist.
Doesn't get any worse than that in America.
God forbid.
The bankers don't cotton to that, boy.
No, it's awful.
They've announced this is their country now.
Yeah, they've taken over, and I guess I'm a threat to national security. I don't know.
Because
don't
the national security is banker run. You are a threat to them.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
You're an American, and a good American is a bad American.
Yeah, and apparently I'm on the watch list now.
You're motivated. You're focused. You're not a jellyfish. You're not a slave. You're working for liberty. You're working for sovereignty. You're working for the family. You're working for health. You're working for truth. You're working for justice. You're the bad man.
Yeah. Yeah. So thank you very much, NSA. It was good to hear from you. I don't know what it was about.
Did you find the whole call history?
Yeah, I'm trying to itemize it right here. It's underneath. Here, I got to find
it. It's a new phone. When did you get that?
I got this phone like a few weeks ago. And the thing is, Alex, you know, normally if I, you know, if you get a call. Oh, here we go. Yesterday. And then you go to call more calls from NSA.
Let me see it.
And here you go.
Here, show that, guys. Show this to folks.
The blue one on the bottom is the incoming call, and the first few times that I was trying to call them, called back. You know, you pull up the number on the phone, and it actually dials the number on this new phone. I'm still figuring out this phone, but if you look there on the bottom, the blue is the incoming call that came in at 12:32 p.m. and I called back at 1:31 p.m. yesterday, the 301 number. So. And then a few times I looked it up, you know, I was talking with Wes yesterday, and, you know, the few times that you try to pull the number up, it was actually dialing the number back. So I wasn't trying to call back that many times. It's just I'm still figuring out this new phone. And, Alex, this is the new AT&T HTC One X phone. It's
well,
like
a lot of what happens is when they've got a tap on the phone, which isn't a tap, it's just all they're hardwired in, and all the as AT&T execs have said, there's whole buildings at AT&T where they spy on you. A lot of times when there's a tap on it, sometimes the number will dial it. But hey, you haven't gotten the call yet, you know, where they tell you, hey, we're listening to you.
Now, you know, the funny thing is
that's really cool though. I kind of like that.
When I came aboard, you know, Alex said, hey, you know, this might happen, Russell. You know, I know you a long time, but you know, you don't be shocked if you get a phone call one day, you know. And I kind of took that with a grain of salt. I mean, you know, okay, Alex. I mean
they'll tell you. They'll tell you I'm gonna chop your head off.
Yeah. Well, you know, this has happened to me on radio shows I've done or broadcasts I've done where, you know, Jim Mars's call will get dropped, things like that. Not so much on my phone, though. That was really different.
You can chalk all that up to paranoia.
Yeah.
But when they call up and say, you're just protesting Bilderberg, they call your wife and say, oh, I'm glad your family member's in the hospital. Or you know, a woman calls. And then once they figure out that you're not buying it, then they'll say, we're listening to you. I mean, it's just over. It's like supposed to freak you out.
That's just.
I guess we're supposed to run like people in you know, in these movies like Enemy of the State, just run in fear. In fact, we have the Enemy of the State trailer. I want to play that when we introduce this amazing family. Great job, Russell.
Well,
we've got the Hernandez family coming in here. Amazing people. I haven't got a chance to fully meet yet. I feel rude. I've been running around like a chicken with my head cut off. Isn't this exciting to be fighting for liberty and they're proving they're evil? They're proving you're right. They're convicting themselves.
It's a good feeling. And I mean, you know.
We're out of time.
We're on the.
All right. Enemy of the state. And we have the NSA calling us. And then, sir, the NSA didn't call you. Yeah. Or somebody spoofed your phone number. And believe me, I've gotten the calls where they tell you what you've been talking about, where they want you to know they're listening. And that's either another agency or Merck groups dialed in there, or it's the NSA. But that's just a cutout group for all these private corporations to use it. The government people actually aren't even let in on much. A bunch of foreign governments run it. It is such treason that they announce on the news foreign banks now run this country. I can play the clips right now. I want my country back right now. That's what I want. I don't want to live in Nazi Germany or Soviet Russia. We know what tyranny is. And folks, people say, well, just don't fight the system. You'll be left alone. They want tyranny because they want to take your pension funds. They want to raise your taxes. They want to run your life. When you let freedom go away, you lose the prosperity. Now, I've got people that I tell you are my new heroes, Andrea Hernandez and Steve Hernandez, because their children or their child go to a school where they're trying to give them satellite tracker boxes. They've got RFID going in. Also in San Antonio, Department of Defense cameras that watch the food the children eat. If you don't believe me, just type in cameras, you know, track what children eat in San Antonio schools. It's a Department of Defense DARPA program. They're trying to have them as lab rats to train them to be prisoners. And they said they'd come on the phone. I said, well, we only got like 20 minutes for you. And they said, well, we'll still drive up. So they were very gracious to come up here on short notice. I could talk to them for 5 hours if we had the time. In fact, I'm tempted to go over there after the show and tape a show for the nightly news, but I've got other meetings set up. But they join us. Here are the headlines out of WOAI-TV and radio. Poll, parents and students oppose new school tracking device. WorldNet Daily, rebellion erupts over school student chipping plan. Continuing here, I mean, it's just big national news. And here they are, Steve Hernandez and his wife. Guys, tell us about yourselves. Tell us about your son who's here and why you guys are doing this.
Well, this is my daughter, Andrea, and this is my son, Vincent.
So we were unable to get your wife in with us,
yeah,
I guess?
My wife wasn't able to make it today,
I mean, that's why I thought, wow, his wife looks really young. Listen, I've been so busy. You've seen me running around in here during the breaks that I just met you right as you came in here. So I thought, yes, because I see quotes of your wife here fighting it as well in the news.
Absolutely.
Okay, well, I mean, tell us about you and your wife and why you're concerned.
Yeah, my wife and I, when we saw this letter that came out on August 10th from John Jay High School, they said they were going to start putting these new smart IDs out there with chips in their tracking chips. And the first thing that came to my mind was Revelations. Because in Revelations, it says you cannot buy, sell without the mark from the beast. Well, we know this isn't the mark of the beast. We know that this is the conditioning of it. They're trying to condition the people into thinking this is normal. This is the norm. And because of our religious beliefs, we said, no, we're not going to allow my daughter to wear that tracking device. And my son goes to NISD school, but he's not being tracked at this moment. But that's what I'm fighting for, not just for my children, but for every student out there, every parent. There's a lot of people out there who are misinformed. They don't know what's going on. They're just saying, hey, you know, it's a great idea. Let's go ahead and do it. NISD has a stronghold. It's a stronghold over parents and teachers and students. They really... God, it's hard to really...
So they're turning it into a prison. I mean, you have Department of Defense. You've seen that on the news where they have the cameras watching what they eat?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And it's an AI computer that can tell how many calories you get watching you eat an apple?
Yes, sir. Absolutely. And that's, you know, that's another thing we're concerned about, because they're trying to take out certain kind of machines out of the schools and put in this kind of machine. They're trying to make the kids into something they want them to be. They're not letting these children be free and to be themselves.
They're saying children shouldn't even play at the park now. They're saying,
and not only should they play at the park, they shouldn't be. They can opt out of gym class now, and all these other things. This is ridiculous. I've seen that.
You're not supposed to have dodgeball or run at recess.
Yeah, because it interferes with their learning capability.
Tell us about your son. I mean, you got your son, your daughter here. You brought some family as well today. Tell us the experience they've had and why they're here.
My son is here to support us, and Vinny's been out there with us 100% pushing this idea and telling us, hey, look, this is not fair, and you didn't ask us. You just put this out there, and I don't want my son, when it comes to his school, supposedly supposed to come to his school, if it does go to his school, he's not going to wear the chip either. That's just plain.
Well, if they get away with this, they can do anything, and they're saying they want to make people do this. This is incredible.
And, you know, and what's crazy here, this program costs $525,000 just for two schools. There's 112 schools in the district, and it costs $136,000 a year to run the program.
It's pure military-industrial complex profiteering, boondoggle.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Well, I mean, you're the expert on this. Tell us all about it, and then anytime your son or daughter want to pop in.
Oh, absolutely. And go ahead, baby.
Yeah, you know, these ideas, they're completely useless. You know, I think it's a waste of all the money that we've been giving to the school for so many years. You know, you're just going to take my money and use it to track me? I already go to school. You have cameras every 5 feet. You know, you have security guards, and you have your admin out in the hallways. You know, that's enough protection as it is.
Protection. Well, guys, can you pull up the Eisenhower quote? He said, safety. If you want safety, go to prison. I mean, this is the opposite of safety, a government trying to make you wear tracker chips. Some of the schools down there, and in Texas, they want a GPS unit.
Yes, sir.
Tell us about this.
And here's the thing.
You have two of them. We can document cam this.
This one is the new tracking chip badge, and this one is their old one. They're trying to say this one's going to make things safer for everybody. I don't understand how it's going to make anybody safer. I really don't. I don't see how it makes people safer. It gives out this. Wade Garcia was on Catherine Albrecht's radio show, okay, from spychips.com, and said, hey, this never shuts off. It's always emitting a signal.
Well, they caught them in San Francisco, where not just the toll roads, but everywhere they put up readers to track the toll road chip. In fact, there it is, guys. We got a document cam on that. There it is. Keep telling us about it, Mr. Hernandez.
You know, and the reason I said this reminds me of Revelations, because she can't even go to school and buy her lunch unless she has this. Kids are being bribed with candy and gifts to wear it around their necks. They're encouraged to wear it around their necks. And then they were also told, and they were also told that they cannot hold leadership positions in school if they don't wear the shit.
So now it's discrimination against Christians or people that don't want to live with a prisoner badge.
Absolutely.
I mean, imagine what Hitler would have done with something like this.
It would have been worse. It would have been worse than what happened. Andrea does want to share some new information that came to us yesterday, and it came straight from her bus driver.
Yeah, my bus driver, I was on the bus, and there's this big old gray box, and I was like, sir, what is that for? He goes, oh, that's for the security cameras. And I was like, okay. And then there's this little black bar, and it's right above the bus driver's window. And I said, sir, what does that do? He goes, oh, that's for that home project. And I was like, what are you talking about? So he goes, you know, your badges. And I was like, so I get tracked on the bus. He goes, yep. So they tracked me on the bus as well.
But then lied. They were in the news saying, we don't track you. Tell folks about that, because we're the enemy. Out of hand, they lie to us on every front.
Yeah, they're like, oh, it only works inside of the school. You know, we can only track you inside of the school. But then they go put trackers on your buses, and then this never turns off. And
just like the laptops. Just like the laptops in Pennsylvania where they watch the kids at home.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We heard about that one, too.
What's incredible is that here you are fighting. Tell folks what you've done. I mean, this has become a big national story. Now the majority of parents I see in the headlines, they don't like it either. We need it, but they're just trying to stonewall and say, we're doing this.
Well, you know, we started out with one newscast in KSAT 12 in San Antonio. And all of a sudden, it just blew up. The gentleman that came here today that's out there in the waiting room, his name is Bobby Scott. And I had to give all respect to him, because if it wasn't for Bobby Scott, I wouldn't be sitting here today with you.
You know what? I just had an epiphany. I've already got two interviews lined up tonight for the nightly news. This is so important. Can you guys, right when the show ends in a few minutes, about 15 minutes, can I have Aaron Dykes, because I've got two meetings I've got to do ahead of the interviews, could you go in and do like a 30, 40-minute interview where you can just cover all of it, show your documents so there's a huge record of this, of what you're doing?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Because I want to respect the fact that you've come here and that I've got such a busy day and I kind of just crammed you in here. I apologize for not being more prepared, because this is so important, sir. And I just want to say I admire you.
Thank you.
You're the type of person that's going to save this country and turn things around.
Thank you.
I just said, you're my hero. I mean that. You're my hero.
Thank you.
People like you, your son who's got the courage to be here, your daughter, your wife who couldn't be here today. I mean, because she's got to work. You guys are incredible. You're normal. This is what a normal person does when they try to give you slave badges.
And let me tell you what. If it wasn't for Bob Scott, I wouldn't be here, because he called me 6 times at work.
Well, we'll interview him in there. Tell us about him. That's why he's here. We'll get him on the TV.
This guy listens to talk radio, and he said, you know, they're talking about you. You need to call this lady, Katie somebody. And it was on the Joe Pag Show. So I Googled it real quick. Oops, I'm not supposed to say Googled. I searched it real quick, and I sent Katie an email. And the next day, Katie called me, and it was blowing up since then. We've had protests in front of Anson Jones Middle School. We didn't get favorable coverage.
That's because you're standing up for those children who are being abused and inducted into a prison state, and the media wants to keep this going. They're collaborating.
We didn't get favorable coverage at all, except for the first two on WOAI Channel 4 and KSAT 12. First two interviews were favorable.
Because they know this could set a precedent nationwide, like Rosa Parks saying, I won't sit at the back of the bus. They need to bring this slave grid in. There's billions behind this.
Oh, yeah. I think yesterday when we were doing the math, came out to almost $40 million for 112 schools. If it's $525,000 for just two schools.
And they want to put them in all San Antonio schools.
110 schools more.
And you're the beta test, because that's where the whole military is.
Absolutely.
And they're rolling it out.
And they want these kids to start wearing it from kinder all the way up to they graduate. No, I'm not going to have that. I would rather homeschool my children first. In fact, I'd rather be here with you today talking about this and help educating people to get this word out. This is ridiculous.
Son, I mean, what's your take on this? Why are you here with your dad?
I'm here to support him. I don't think that my sister or I should ever have to wear this badge. I mean, it's pointless. And all the money that they're putting to the badges, it could be used for other things like athletics, teachers and stuff.
Tutoring.
Yeah.
But instead, it's being used to teach you the most important thing, that you're a prisoner. and that Big Brother is going to watch everything you do. This is like a science fiction movie.
Yeah, it is.
And by the way, you said it's leading to the beast. I agree, but it's pretty much kind of that link, that final link, because you got a thumbprint face scan in most schools now to get your lunch. That's already digitally connected. That's already tracking you. To get library books, this is going in tanning salons, bookstores. They've got Facebook now trying to make you use this to buy and sell. It's here. We're in trouble. And it turns out Facebook is CIA. Google's NSA. Everything's coming out. They built this whole fake grid for us.
Absolutely. I agree with you 100%. The things that we've been finding out ever since Katie and Catherine and Liz McIntyre have been talking with us. I mean, we are changed San Antonio and Lightmead. We are changed Texas Hill Country. All these folks come to my house, visit with me, call me on the phone. I mean, my email is just blown up.
For those that don't know, We Are Change is a group that came out of a fellow at Luke Radowski I supported that's grassroots, another basically info warrior group of people that just aren't left or right. They stand for basic freedom.
Absolutely.
Like, hey, our kids shouldn't wear tracker chips that even follow them outside school, and the Department of Defense shouldn't have $500,000 AI computers watching the kids.
You know, and we went to NISD, and we were given Citizens to Speak Hour. Okay, so Citizens to Be Heard Hour came up, and we went up there. I was the first one, then Andrea, and then the rest of the folks who were there. And the lady by the name of Karen Freeman, she was, we call her the president because she was kind of running the whole show. She said, you know, we're going to give you this time to speak, but we don't have to act on this.
Oh, they always want you to know you don't have power. I've had the mayor and people, when I was fighting the Patriot Act, walk off stage. And they want you to know, you got your time to speak, but we're not listening. You don't have power, little man.
We couldn't clap. We couldn't cheer. We couldn't do nothing. They told Matthew Medina, if you clap one more time, you're out of here. We'll have you escorted. But, you know, and it's fine. We don't mind. Matthew got actually got a ticket for using a bullhorn to help protest because the police said he broke the barrier, the sound.
Which, by the way, it didn't, because I've seen but that's it. They're getting scared. Oh, no, they're not going to let us turn them into prisoners. You know, this is our food. We're the government. These are our cows. No cows. You're our food. You're our slave.
You know, the NISD police department, we were listening to them talk when we were outside Anson Jones, and they're actually telling their parents, oh, this is a great, great idea, because if there was a fire, we can track your children. And I'm kind of thinking to myself, okay, if you're going to track my children, who's going to track the poor guy who's tracking the children in the room? Who's going to save him?
Well, look, the whole point is they never use the cameras or any of this. It's all about control.
Mm-hmm. It's all about money and control. That's all it is. I went to John Jay High School 25 years ago. There's no difference now. I hear a lot of people. Let me tell you, I've been chastised. I've been yelled at. I've had arguments with people. But you know what? They keep telling me, Steve, keep your mouth shut. Just tell your daughter to put the badge on and go to school and learn something.
And do the next thing. Now they're starting forced inoculation outside of law. It's a felony. They're injecting nationwide and injecting your children and lying and saying it's the law when it's a policy, not a law. And again, a government that'll do this, I wouldn't trust them with the vaccines. There's a whole history of that. But you know the clip from Bug's Life. If you let one ant stand up, they might all stand up. That's why they're telling you, who is a hero for just being normal, you're bad. You're bad. Steve Hernandez, he's bad. His daughter, Andre Hernandez, you're bad. Your son, you're bad, because you don't want to be a prisoner.
And, you know, let me tell you what. There are teachers who don't want to speak up, and they're Christians because they're afraid to lose their jobs. I have a friend of mine.
Well, there you are, and they'll take the mark of the beast then if they're scared now. Folks, if you're not taking action now, when will you?
Absolutely.
Well, they tell them that's why you're going to be raptured, so you don't have to worry about it. That's all been pre-planned.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter. God will say he doesn't know you if you don't stand up against this.
Absolutely. Yeah,
what you do to the least of me, you've done to me. All these enforcers need to know that. Hurting children and innocent people, better to tie a millstone around your neck and throw yourself in the ocean.
Absolutely.
You'll call that a terror threat. No, you don't have to worry about me. God is going to cut you down if you don't repent right now. We'll be right back. Sooner or later, going to cut you down. Eisenhower quote on screen. Dwight D. Eisenhower, speaking to a major university, you can look it up, it's a vetted quote, said, if you want total security, go to prison. There you're fed, clothed, and given medical care, and so on. The only thing lacking is freedom. And, you know, that's the fact here. The NSA has been caught spying on everyone, political people. They're now arresting peaceful protesters, saying it's terrorism to protest. That's mainstream news. The hour is late. This is Department of Defense run. I'm not against our military, but our government's been taken over. It's been taken over by globalists who say they've conquered this nation, foreign banks. And it was about 12 years ago, WorldNet Daily reported on it. You can look this up. In Louisiana, they tried to make them wear these RFID badges, and satellite trackers are now coming out. And and first they tried to expel people, but then others joined the children, like a prison break, you know, a protest, and they had to remove them. So they're scared because they've tried to do this over and over again, and they're acting like you're weird. They're acting like you're crazy. They've been trying this for 20 years. So remember that, Mr. Hernandez. They've got PSYOPs people. This is multi-billions nationwide to get this in.
Absolutely.
They are scared of you. They know you're in the right, and they want to make you think you're bad. What response have you gotten from family? You were talking to me during the break.
You know, I hardly any response from family. I get more support from strangers and people at work than I do from families. I've asked people to support me, go into the girls' Facebook site and put something positive, help us out. I mean, because they're all Christians. And I have a lot of Christian friends and family who think it's fine. They think it's absolutely fine what they're doing. And unfortunately...
Well, you were saying even more during the break. I mean, some people are telling you in the family. I mean, tell us.
I don't get, like, any response from my family. I'm getting, like... people that are supposed to be friends that are turning their backs on me saying, just wear it. It's just a badge. And I was like, no, this is a lot bigger than just a badge. It's not just a badge. It's a badge is this. This is a badge. This is a chip.
That's a tracker. Exactly. A barcode's one thing. And we always said it'll lead to chips next with the barcodes.
Yes.
It was Louisiana said no to the barcodes, actually. Because people can read those, by the way, and then get your personal data.
Yes.
You can, with the eye, read a barcode once you learn the spaces. Son, you were wanting to show people the signs you've got for protesting. One of you was telling me during the break, though, about family saying, hey, quit it.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
There you go. I am not a number. And then you've got the other one, Tracking No, and that's Catherine Albrecht right here on the Genesis Network who helped you out with those. Well, I mean, here's the deal. Where do you go from here? Because you've got all these other documents and articles you'll be able to cover on the nightly news.
You know, just to hit real quick on what you're saying about family, I had a family member text me yesterday, and he says, you know, you're always into something. Why can't you just leave stuff alone? Just tell your daughter, put the badge on, go to school and learn something. Well, let me ask you something, I'm sure he's going to not like this, but I'm going to tell you anyways. How is a tracking chip going to make her learn? It's not going to help her with her education.
It's going to make her learn to wear a prisoner badge.
Exactly. It's going to condition her, make her learn to be conditioned and think everything's okay. It's not the norm.
They now put people through body scanners at Sony factories and stuff. I mean, we're being inducted into a prison culture, and it's so incredible. Tell us about your Facebooks and things, how people can help you.
Oh, absolutely. The girls, I set up a Facebook. It's called Students Against RFID Tracking. And my Facebook is linked to theirs. So whatever I post on mine, I post on theirs. You know, for those who support us, you know, go in there and put your comments, your opinions, send pictures.
Oh, well, we're going to tweet your Facebook right now. Will you guys ask somebody to tweet for me because I got my hands full? Tweet that out, that everybody needs to stand with you, because they don't want you to have solidarity, aid, and comfort.
No, they
don't want American patriots to have aid and comfort. They want to make you feel like you're alone and demoralized.
And, you know, and we're telling everybody, look, if you want to learn more about this, go to spychips.com, because they're posting everything that we're doing in San Antonio on their website to help us. You know, let me tell you what, these ladies have just been overwhelming. He's supportive and a great people.
Well, they're looking for a hero. I mean, they understand you're there in the fight. Everybody nationwide. This is happening everywhere, by the way.
Yes, sir. Yes.
You're just one of the few people that's got half a brain to realize the evil. And, sir, I salute you. We'll have more on the nightly news on this and more, 7 o'clock tonight.